Well, good evening, everybody. I hope everybody's having a good one, and thanks for coming in to chill with us as we talk about this great movie. And joining me is to my left, yes, my left, the drunk poet, Dipsy. How you doing, man?
I'm doing amazingly well. Thanks for having me on. Talks about such a great movie, great people. It's gonna be a good time. I got a lot to say.
Yeah,
Appreciate it.
great. Yep, good to have you. Right below me is uninspired. Welcome, sir.
Hey, good evening, man. Thanks for having me on.
Yep, definitely. And Blair, welcome back, sir. It's
Thank you.
been a bit.
Yeah, it's been a busy month, so I got my work done, so now I can play.
Yeah,
Nice.
good deal. Well, so First Blood, yeah. When was the first time y'all saw this movie?
It. I saw it. I had already seen part two, and then I went back and retroactively watched this one and didn't like it when I first saw it, comparatively. I was more into the action and shoot 'em up explosions kind of stuff. And there, this movie was a little bit slower in that aspect. But now that I'm older, I have a different perspective on it that I'll get into more later.
Yeah. I mean, like me for the first time, it
Okay.
was I guess it was when I was a kid. Actually when I was a teenager, I think I was around 14 or 15, and I had heard a lot about the Rambo franchise. I'd heard about like Stallone, so I was kind of looking at all of the original the 80s action heroes and looking at their big movies. And so I just stumbled upon Rambo, and I had only seen I guess glimpses of the other films at that time because they used to show on TV. And so you just like also you just knowing the personal stuff surrounding it, like, oh yeah, it's just a really, really cool high octane action franchise. And so I decided to watch First Blood, and man, I was really shocked by how different it was in comparison to what I had heard of the Rambo franchise, which was interesting. So yeah, and I really, really liked it.
I saw it when it came out. I think it was HBO, maybe a year or so after. And it's kind of wild because I remember there's a scene where he's driving a truck and he crashes through a barricade. I remember that was like one of the commercials for HBO showing that, this is gonna be First Blood, the movie. And yeah, I was about 11 or 12 when I saw it. Definitely
Cool.
set the
Yeah,
stage for
I
the
was.
80s.
Yeah, it did. Yeah, I saw it probably in the 90s when I was about the same age. So on TV. But yeah. Great movie. You
And there was a Nintendo
it's one of
Entertainment
those you don't
System video
appreciate
game that
when
was
you're
one of them.
younger. Oh yeah. Cool. It's one of those movies you don't appreciate when you're younger, but once you get older and kind of it grows on you more.
Agreed.
But yeah, it's a pretty
Yeah,
good
you
movie.
can. I
The
think this is
I
the
like
best of all the
to
Rambo movies.
yeah, probably 100% actually. It's just because it has depth in comparison to the rest.
Right. He's not just a
Yeah,
one-dimensional
let me
killing machine
say
that
hello
needs
to
to be a
the
flesh terminator.
Yeah. Let's say hello to the chat real quick. Got first one in, Ms. Martin. Hello there. Jay Goodwin. What's up, man? Sammy, what up? Let's see here. Cannoli. Nothing is
Sasquatch.
over.
What's up?
And we got
That's such good
the other
dialogue in
Jay.
this. Gooch.
What's up?
Yes. Yeah, really, really good dialogue.
Yeah, certainly. He had some great one-liners, even before that was really a trope. Because he did a lot of the tropey things before they were tropes. And kind of set the stage for those to become tropes down the road.
Yeah, and it's interesting because it's like The role of Rambo, especially in First Blood, requires a lot of subtlety in the acting, which is right. something that I wouldn't think Stallone would have had in terms of range. Because I do think that Stallone has range compared to his contemporaries of the time. Although, just to have that subtlety is something that's very demanding, especially when you're doing a lot of physical stuff at the same time. And to see him pull it off, it was like, I was glad.
Yeah, agreed. Surprised.
Yeah,
because the entire movie is resting on his shoulders. It really
right.
is.
Yeah. I think the fact that he's a writer, too, probably helps a lot. I mean, you know, Arnie was just a bodybuilder.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, but Stallone actually did write and actually, you know, had a Oscar writing for mm-hmm. Rocky. So he could, you know, he had some depth to him.
Yeah, certainly. And it, not just that, but the special effects in this movie are pretty darn good.
Yeah.
There was a certain point in this movie where I didn't think it was fake. It looked mm-hmm. like he's really stitching his arm up. And I mean,
yeah, that was good. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was good.
And the blood coming out added a good effect.
Yeah. It was so good. So
really, really good practical stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, the guys, the stuntman falling off the cliffs into the pads out in the woods, and the clear shot makes it look like he goes all the way down. You can't even see the pads these dudes are laying on.
Mm-hmm. Yep, it
looks great.
I mean, they still did it, and they still did it. You know, it's a significant amount of work that they had to pull off, anyways. So it's like, yeah, and there it is. It stands the test of time because we're still talking about it. How many years later? 40 years later.
Yeah. Plus the you know the violence and the shooting, it was realistic. That could actually really happen. It wasn't like over the top crazy crap, you know.
Right. Yeah, he used his brain and training to actually do things that most people would think we wouldn't think about doing. He goes to take out the power and you know things of this nature. It's really really well done. I honestly don't know how they were able to write a character so convincingly. With that level of skill, because I have no skill in that level, even close, but I can still, find things about him that I identify with and, you know, things of that.
Yeah. Nature. Yeah. I mean, like that's the interesting part is that it's kind of the fact that you identify with, I would say his journey, because it's like you can't identify with the physical stuff that he does, but you can identify with what he's going through. Maybe there's a point in your life where you felt like everyone was against you for no reason whatsoever, and you just had to get up and fight. And that's it, you know?
Agreed.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I love the way that they do his building here in the beginning, that this very dramatic scene to set up everything. Such a good way to set the tone for the film.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and even then, it's like this is where Stallone's subtlety like shines. Really, just once he's talking to this woman, it's like, yeah, he's gone. That was it. I don't know. I personally wouldn't have added the score in this scene because I think that it would have more weight if it was like completely silent. But I still don't think that the score takes away from what we were seeing.
Right.
Right.
So yeah. Good.
Do you guys think they'd ever remake First Blood?
No. I hope they don't.
Somebody would, but I hope they don't.
Yeah, right. They better not. Yeah.
Right. I have The Rock in there as Rambo.
But it's a very...
Jesus.
It's a very simple opening and just a, you know, just a horn playing.
Right.
I thought it was a very pretty simple opening.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the lone horn symbolizing he's the only one left.
Yep.
Right.
Yeah. And he's got everything that he owns right there with him right now.
Yep.
All you need, you can carry it on your back. That's it.
That's right. Apparently he stinks
Sammy,
at this point.
Don't say that.
I said bring it up.
Don't say that, Sammy.
Lizzo ate Rambo, but...
Lizzo first blood sausage. But no, what a great scene here. so serene. It just setting everything up. He's got all this high spirits up. Yeah, I'm getting ready to go visit my buddy, man. I haven't seen him since the war.
And they make it lighthearted too. You have kids right. playing around. The music is very lighthearted and charming. Even just the location of where it is, you know, it's like, yeah, this is a good place to I guess relax after the war.
Right. Mm-hmm. Then you start looking around and realize, like that house right there, it's falling apart.
Mm-hmm.
These are shanties. Yeah. These people are poor.
Yeah.
Poor. Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hard times. And he's showing him, hey, you know, this is. You know, he wrote this down right here. Look, you can tell it's his writing.
Yeah, he's so enthusiastic about it too. Right. That's what's really sells it. You know, that's it. It's very, very interesting.
Right.
Yeah.
And honestly, I would disagree with Jay there. I don't think that's racial tension. I think that's back then that people were real standoffish with the military coming back from Vietnam. Like that, that's the theme throughout the whole movie.
Mm. Yeah.
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 But I mean, you know, always there's always going to be racial tension of some type.
That's true.
But then he's also representing a piece of her son's past too that killed him. So she's
right.
not going to be happy.
Right. He's like, check it out. Look, I got a picture of us. Right. And this picture is one of his prized possessions.
It's not until she tells him that he's dead that the look on his face tells her that. This wasn't just they were actual buddies and
mm-hmm.
knew each other.
Right.
Yeah, and also I think it's maybe the fact that it's a reminder of her son going to war, and you know, he died of cancer, and that's a very slow death, depending on where it is. And you know, maybe he told her stuff that he did in the war that she would find absolutely traumatizing. And so to have someone like a physical representation of that just come and stay in front of you and say, yeah, I did this, and show him a picture of the buddies, you know, it's like, I understand though, if it would rub her the wrong way.
Right.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the grieving process is hard. You know, it's only been a year
mm-hmm.
and he went out in a really slow, painful, terrible, wasting kind of way.
Mm-hmm.
The Agent Orange. Yeah.
It's like a friendly fire thing. We sprayed it on our people and they died from it.
Yeah.
Right.
Yep. Love the smell of napalm in the morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Right.
Man. Yeah, so okay. rough. And he ends up giving her the picture. He hands it to her. And that's his thing. Like out of the very few possessions he has in the whole world, he gave her that. And he was the last one.
Yeah.
Yeah, he has no need for it because they're all dead now.
Right.
So
mm-hmm.
why keep it, you know?
Yeah, and you only learn that they're all dead at the end of the movie in his big speech.
Right. And this scene, this is iconic right here.
I read one of the other, they were going to make this two previous times. And in the first one, it was going to, Steve McQueen was going to play Rambo.
Mm-hmm.
But he was too old.
Yeah,
for the role
by 1982,
he's like in his 40s. Yeah, and most soldiers coming back from Vietnam were early 20s. Still, you know, they were still young.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. I mean, it's interesting because Steve McQueen himself died of cancer, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because of the war.
Yeah.
Actually, yeah. So I think he died in 1980. Yeah, it's interesting, but I don't know. I like Steve McQueen. I really do like Steve McQueen, but I don't think that he would have suited the role of John Rambo. But then again, I'm saying this from a 1980s perspective. So maybe if Steve McQueen was in it, they would have probably done it in the 70s or I guess late 60s, which would have been a completely different movie in of itself. You know, it wouldn't have that 80s action in it.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah,
would have been much.
Welcome to Hope.
Yeah. Gateway to Holiday Land.
Holiday Land.
Mm-hmm.
That got me. He's walking into Hope, and there's no hope there because they want him out.
Right. Right. They do that again. They show Hope in the center of the shot later. They do that quite often, actually. Yeah, the sticker on the door talking about how it cures the burglary, cures mm-hmm. the common burglary.
Yeah, it's crazy because it's like they do everything to try and establish that it's a very small town. And right. It's like this sheriff that you see, the first time you see him, he's saying hi to everyone. Just say like, yeah, yep. this is my domain, ladies and gentlemen.
Right by name.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah.
Monica Rambeau. You got to stop bringing up the Marvels. It's traumatized you enough, man.
I know, right?
This movie is about trauma.
Mm-hmm.
It's a healing process.
There it is right there. Hope, that was the shot. Yeah, they have the Hope Hotel in the background, but it's in the center of the shot. At these old signs, really. I was looking for gas prices, but I didn't see any.
Same, actually. Weirdly yeah. enough, I did the same. Right. I couldn't find any. Even when he blows up the station.
This,
right.
This guy here in the hard hat, the sheriff says to him, are you going to take a bath sometime this week?
Yeah, like, yeah. Right.
After he's in really got something weird about taking baths.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He's a coke and a smile.
Yeah.
He's a Bob. He's the Eisner of his dime. He probably takes 2 showers a day.
Right. And
they got a big problem with hippies.
Yeah. And also like the town itself, the location, I'm incredibly satisfied with, I guess, the location scouts of the film finding this very little place in the middle of the mountains where you can clearly see everything around you. It creates this sense of, I guess you could say it's a bit of freedom, but at the same time, you're in captivity in a place of freedom, you know, for John Rambo. It's very interesting.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah, his hope was in this town. Mm-hmm. His last hope.
Sure.
Now he's void of hope, and he's the way that they have everything set up with the fog, the way it lays out in the background of that shot right there, the way yep. that the town all lays down, and from where he's at up in the mountains later you can see everything, and he mm-hmm. can get up on top of one building and see his whole town.
Yep.
Well, yeah, I completely yep. agree. That's a good point, man. I hadn't even considered that. Yeah, good point.
And there he is, Brian Dennehy, man. Really, really great casting.
Yeah, agreed.
What you doing here, stranger, with your long hair and that American flag?
Right. Just so like that, you're looking for trouble.
Like yeah. Abuse of power, man. Abuse yeah. of authority.
Oh, agreed.
The guy literally did nothing, and he's just trying to run him out of town.
Right.
Yeah, just because it's his town. It's just, I guess it's hubris at this point, you know. All of the cops, right. actually, they show them having a vast amounts of hubris, except for, I guess, Mitch is his name. Yeah, that's it. All of the rest are just abuse of power all the way through. It's like, if this dude, John Rambo, is capable of fighting back, imagine what they do to the people that can't fight back.
Oh, yeah.
Right. Yeah. That the you're gonna do that to the wrong person one day in person shows up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, right.
F around yep. and find out, you know.
That's right. John
Rambo is like the definition of chart.
Yep. Keeps looking at because he's got the long hair going and the scruff beard, the 5 o'clock shadow.
Mm-hmm.
He's been walking down the road for days, who knows how long. Because, you know. They teach you how to walk in the army, vast distances, yeah. right? I mean, who knows how long he's been walking.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, this guy's like, go take a shower, hippie. Here, I'll drop you off outside of town.
It's like, can I somewhere have, to
eat? Yeah.
Yeah, somewhere
30 to miles yeah. away. Yeah, 30 right. miles away.
Right. Yeah, I'll drop you off 15 miles away from it. Have fun.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's right at the county yeah, cool. line, too.
Yeah, right. on the Evil Dead Bridge.
Right. I like to call I kept it. Thinking that too, right?
The Sam Raimi Bridge.
Right.
Look at that bridge in Dante's Peak too. The one that
oh,
the
yeah.
Bloods.
Uh huh. Yeah.
Forgot about that movie. It's a good movie.
And to, you know, he's done nothing wrong here, and right. he has every right to walk into that town.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He wasn't even being rude
to him unless he's committed a crime. No.
Right.
Yeah. I just love
the way I'm going back. I'm going back.
Yeah, he looks and then he's like, "Yep, I'm going." He just breaks. Like, nope. What are you doing? Like, come on, dude. And yeah, rightfully he's ignoring him because you can.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah, the right to travel, man.
Mm-hmm. Especially in the 80s, man.
Right. Yeah, before 9/11, everything before the Patriot
Act. Could have just gone anywhere. Nobody would care.
Yeah, except apparently this guy.
Yeah.
we don't like your kind here. No vagrants. Which, I mean, they're in Washington. I get it. You know, get...
I'm just kidding.
Yeah. I'm just saying.
Yeah, I mean, I guess they would treat him differently if he just had a haircut, took a shower, and then came back, possibly. Right. But even then, I really doubt it, because it looks as if the sheriff just doesn't want any outsiders, you know?
Right.
Yeah.
Once again, it's control.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Control.
Yeah, yeah. Like this, he's like, oh, what do you use this for? Oh, hunting.
Yeah. What do you hunt? Name it. Anything. Everything.
Yeah, so a huge knife too, man.
Yeah.
This started the craze of the survival knife.
Yes.
Because I remember being a kid buying one that you could unscrew, take out your old garrot string and your matches, and it had the compass in it.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Wasn't that fishing line?
Yeah, it was fishing line too.
Matches. Yeah, stuff like that. Have a saw blade on the back so you could cut wood with it. Yep, yeah, that was Jimmy Lyle who did the knife design. He did the knife design for the first three movies of this.
They all look fantastic.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, they do.
Oh, cool.
Agreed.
Really, really fantastic.
Yeah. Yeah, super effective with it, too.
Like, mm-hmm.
Wow, that's all he needs.
And plus, they emphasize on how sharp it is. Like, he just slices through paper instantly. Yeah. Yep, done. Really, really interesting.
Like, this guy's on it. He's got a really sharp knife.
I mean,
like, they should have done the background check a little faster.
Where is this filmed?
Somebody said Canada, but I don't know.
I mean, a small town, USA. How many guys do you know that are carrying around a knife that big?
I mean,
British Columbia.
Glove box or
that's Ottoman. Actually true. Especially in the location where it is, you know, clearly in the mountains where it looks like people hunt.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. I guess it's just the fact that he is an outsider that they really emphasize on it.
Yeah.
And even here, just more good acting, great acting from Stallone, where, of course, Rambo is silent throughout this entire thing. And you can clearly see that he's scanning the entire police station.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Remembering everything.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's efficiency.
Yeah, this is not his first time being captured against his
will. Got his head on a swivel. Mm.
That's right.
As we find out.
And this is kind of like easy level for him. He's already played it on hardcore difficulty. It's an easy mode.
Yeah.
He's got a game genie at this point.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They keep cops, having those little flashes in there.
Yeah.
Frames. Yeah, right here is where, one of those.
Yep.
It's a great way to convey exposition without having, because I feel like if they remade Rambo today, what they probably would have done was at the beginning of the movie, it would have probably been a 10-minute flashback. Then after that, sprinkled throughout the movie, you would have had lengthy flashbacks of him and his brothers in arms being tortured. And then at the end of the movie, he'd have his speech where they'd probably do another flashback. And I don't know, I think this is enough to convey all that you need to know. That's it. Just flash,
him as a kid,
you understand.
Right. Him as a kid getting some kind of like advice from an older relative who ends up dying.
Yeah. Right?
With great responsibility comes great power or something.
Basically, yeah.
Right.
Give me just a sec, guys.
Yeah.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah, this is perfect how they do a quick shot. And you know exactly what it is. He was captured and he is being tortured.
Yeah. And in very, very similar ways. And oh man, that's just the expressions on his face while this is all happening too. Like you were saying, his subtlety and his acting. Mm-hmm. Wow. Completely believable at this point in the movie. I was completely immersed in it. I was waiting on how this was all going to play out. You know, the music is real, real light and subtle in the background. There's not mm-hmm. a lot of flashy effects or anything, but then out of nowhere, there's these wild, like torture scenes that come out of nowhere. So well done. So well done.
Yeah, and the way that they come out, the way that they come at you is also interesting. It's like, I guess that's how PTSD would work. You know, it just mm-hmm. spray at you whenever, especially unsuspecting, and it would just be like a flash. And also, you know, Stallone, he has the deer in headlights look. You know, it's like the lights are on, but it doesn't look like no one's home. You know what I mean? Right. It's very, very.
Yeah, kind of zones out, and they, you know, they think he's being disrespectful and weird and all mm-hmm. that, but no, the guy's just having, you know, flashbacks.
Right. Yeah, and I mean, I guess wouldn't you guys assume that the cops would understand this? That's like at least right. at a minimum level. Well, what do you guys think?
You would think.
Especially the head sheriff, because I think in the book he was also a vet, but of Korea, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you see right. his office, so, you see his medals.
Right. So it's like,
yeah,
he should know exactly what's going on here. Should. But at this point, they don't know he's military, right?
Yeah, but this is like, this can't be the first, right. you know, former service member. I mean, I'm sure people from that town were in Vietnam too.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And had their own, you know, issues.
Right.
So it shouldn't be so foreign.
Right. Well, I think at a certain point he kind of turns where it's like, I was kind of zoned out having a flashback and wasn't speaking. And now you just threatened me to talk. So I'm not going to talk. You can't make me.
Mm-hmm.
Like better than you have tried to make me talk and it failed. And you're going to fail now. And then that guy puts his hand on him to grab his dog tags. And he's like,
yep.
Instant. Like, I will break you, dude.
Nope. That's the, what's it called? That's the dude from, I forget his name.
CSI.
Yeah. David Caruso. Yeah. CSI, that's his name. It's weird. It's only on this watch that I realized it was him. I never knew how I didn't catch that as a kid. Cause I used to watch CSI a lot as a kid. So it's really, really weird that I didn't realize it was him.
Right.
He's so young too. He's Rambo, practically a kid.
John Jay.
Yeah. Man. Yep. And Stallone had a chiseled face. I have to admit, dude looked like a model. It's crazy.
Right. This is fresh out of his adult acting career, right?
Mm. Oh yeah. 1982.
Yep. Which, by the way, the editing in this movie, too.
I was thinking.
No, go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, it's the editing in this movie.
I was thinking when the sheriff grabbed him.
Go ahead, Jacob.
You're good. You go. You go. You go. I was just thinking when the sheriff grabbed his arm earlier, the sheriff should have thought, this guy's got some big arms. I better be careful. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you know, the cops are used to the guns, but hey, he's brought the gun show right here.
Yeah, so. Right.
Right. Red.
But yeah, the editing in this movie, it's only the second time, the second project this editor had ever done.
Oh, wow.
And the first project was an assistant editing job. So, I mean, with Joan Chapman, also worked on Seven and Weekend at Bernie's.
Nice.
Yeah.
Well,
man, what a way to start your career, first blood.
Right?
That's really good.
Home run, man. I mean, the editing was really good. We were just talking about how it affected us, right? A couple frames here, a couple frames there. Super effective way to tell it.
Yeah, and it's even interesting, like the director, Ted Kochev. Even him, you know, you look at his filmography, he hasn't done a lot of, I guess, high action stuff before this. It was more of like either comedies. He did a few westerns, but still they were pretty low budget in comparison to the westerns that you had at the time, you know.
Right.
So it's, even then, it's very interesting to see how this came together.
Agreed.
Right.
Yeah, this scene, he's resisting the branding.
He looks more confused by the printing than resisting.
Right. Yeah, I know, right?
What are you doing? Stop pushing my hand like that. Don't
put this on me. I had ink on my fingers.
Where are you getting my fingers dirty? Come on, man.
Yeah, and then of course it's like Sheriff again, just abusing of his authority.
Yep.
It's wanting him to get washed up. I don't know why.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the young officers right here, they should have been like, okay, you just have a seat there. You be okay. And they should have backed off right there.
Yeah, it's like David Caruso's character, Mitch. He's very, very hesitant to do all of this stuff. Every time the chiefs or the senior officers do something, he's the first person to say, "Don't do that." You know, like, is that necessary?
Yeah.
There they go.
Fire hose, cold water too.
Yeah.
Laughing at him while they're basically stripping his skin off.
Yeah.
Really, really horrible, man.
Yep.
But hey, he's still on easy mode. He's probably had it way worse.
It's true. You know, and narratively, they're setting this up to where no matter what Rambo does, you're going to like him as a character because these other people are so dislikable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They're doing everything wrong. They're abusing their power. They're abusing this guy. It's just so wrong. And this scene here with the razor blade. Oof.
It's basically what the inciting incident that launches everything. Right. Really,
the
really good.
The straw that broke the camel's back, right?
You guys ever heard of Bic disposable razors? I mean, come on, you know.
Right?
They bring out the big-ass fucking straight razor.
Right.
Just watch and plus they bring the rock to sharpen it and everything. It's like, come on, dude. Why?
I know, right? It's like, a bit overkill.
Yes, it's pure intimidation at that point. You know, they didn't have to do it. They didn't even have to shave him. They just want to do it to prove to him that, we're in power and you aren't.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Well, it's like, not going to work out well.
Don't worry about the soap. And then he's like, don't worry about the soap. Shave him dry. It's like, oh,
right.
Goodness.
Like, man, he was hard to get a hold of. Yeah, that's your first sign, buddy.
Yeah, it's like, it's interesting because this entire sequence, it shows you one big thing about John Rambo in comparison to everyone else. It shows you that the officers are no match, not only in raw strength, but in technique as well.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And it's like, these dudes are nothing compared to John Rambo. And it just adds to selling on that believability, you know, your suspension of disbelief that this dude is capable of doing what he does later on in the film.
Yep.
Oof.
Wow. Yikes, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah, they gave him the goatee.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Crucified up with the crown on and everything.
Mm-hmm. Man. Mm. Yikes.
Here we go.
Snap. There we go.
One star. One star. Beats up everybody here in this whole place.
Oh, yeah. I mean, everyone.
Boom.
Maybe they should have used the soap.
If they did, at least he would probably be slipping or something. They'd have a fighting chance.
And he about got him right here. Yeah. I thought he was going to poke his eyes out. I thought he was done.
Dude, but I don't know if you've seen,
he just goes through them like they're not even there.
Exactly, yeah. And dude, I've been to Cannes, right? So, you know, like where the Cannes Film Festival is. And over there, they have the printings, the handprints of all the major actors. And Sylvester Stallone's hand is massive. When I say massive, I don't even mean like my dad has huge hands. And my dad's hands, when he put it in the print, they look like baby hands in comparison to Stallone's. It is insane how massive this dude was, especially just like raw strength. So here, right. You know, in his prime 80s, dude, man, this is even believable if it was just Stallone breaking out of a out of a police station, man.
Right. He pulls some WWE style kicks and stuff here. Like some of them look better than others.
Mm-hmm.
Like the that right there looked like that hurt real bad. Like that elbow in the face. Yeah. He just comes running outside. At this point in the book, I believe he's butt naked.
Oh wow.
Right. Like they had to change that for the movie for, you know, obvious reasons.
Oh, they probably changed it because it was cold outside.
Right. Yeah. Which is a point they keep bringing up visually where he's like shivering and he goes and like the first thing he does when he's out there is he goes into survival mode.
Mm-hmm. You can see the breath too. It's cold.
Right.
Yeah. When he's climbing up the side of the ridge, they really emphasize every single breath he takes. It's just smoke is coming out.
Right. And this is what, like 5 minutes after they got done spraying him with that hose. So he's soaking wet too. His hair's wet. He was cold to begin with from the hose water. Now he's outside in this crap and on a motorcycle.
He's going to shoot downrange with a rifle like that.
At people, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Picked off
down the road, down Main
Street. Five people would have been killed too. Just
go through a few people, you know?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, like that just shows you a lot about them, the police, like especially this guy, because when he's in the helicopter after Ian warns him, he's like, "Yeah, I'll kill you if you don't like let me line up the shop." It's like, all right, you understand that these people are basically just out for blood, and they have no reason to be. I guess you could say that they're just itching for a fight, especially in their small town over there. Once they have the opportunity, it's like, yeah, we need to show the townsfolk that we're capable. It's like, all right.
Yeah, capable against this homeless guy that randomly showed up.
Yeah.
Because they don't know he's military yet. Mm. Like, the thing that hadn't come in yet. Or could say,
you could assume that he's military. I mean, I would personally assume that he's military. Yeah.
Right. Well, I suppose what I meant to say was they don't know he's special forces yet.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
That's what I meant, yeah. Yeah, and this, he knocks the gun up in the air. Don't shoot. The guy shoots anyway. Yeah.
Who's the crazy person here?
Oh, right.
Yeah, I know, right?
Rambo literally hasn't done anything yet. Well, I mean, well, beat up a couple cops and escape custody, but...
Well, I mean, technically, that, at this point, it's a crime, you know?
Right. Right.
Yeah.
I mean, he's even considering and telling people to move. He's saying, yeah, get out of the way. Get out of the way.
Right.
Yeah, the officer didn't care. He probably would have shot through 10 people. Yep. Right. That's a dumb day.
You can see the ramp right there where he comes off there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That is insane.
Really good.
Yeah.
That whole suspension would be gone on that real. Yeah. That had been like a regular car.
Yeah,
right. Dude, car suspension in movies, like it's Fast and Furious all the time, man. Car suspension would break after every single jump that you see in a movie.
Right. But this like right here, where the stuntman
like the
comes
one in
up
the in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. In the beginning of Speed, that when that first show the cop car comes over, and it's like, what? It's like 30 feet in the air.
Yeah.
No, you're right. Coppa, that's not a crime. That's just how people say hello. Right? Hey, man, I don't know. At this point, he's in survival mode. This guy is, his survival mode is better than yours. And he's going to show you. He'll prove it over and over and over. Yeah. And this is great because they have no idea that they just unleashed the giant.
Oh yeah. And then of course, you know, you've got the chief that just thinks that he's the best, but nope. He's about to be humbled. He's really about to be humbled to the point where he's shaking up himself.
Right.
Yeah.
Man, all of this also, you know, big shout out to the stuntmen. Yeah, for actually doing all of this.
Yeah.
But today would have been on a green screen.
Agreed. And these stuntmen did stuff like Bonanza and Halloween 2, Ghostbusters, Terminator, Commando. Will Harper did Guardians of the Galaxy, Doctor Strange, Winter Soldier, the 84 Dune. He did the 84 Dune stuff. And wow. Yeah, I mean, it's just crazy. The one guy did Incredible Hulk, Rocky III, Star Trek III, Die Hard, Hunt for Red October, Basketball, Pearl Harbor.
Like, Jesus.
Yeah, these guys' resume is just off the charts on pretty much every aspect of this, except their editor, who did an amazing mm-hmm. job.
Oh, I've had the sheriffs is crashing through everybody's fences and, you know, right. health, yeah. everybody else. You
I
know.
Think, sure.
The state will pay for it. Don't worry.
Yeah, right.
Really. Yeah, he'd be like,
my cows got out.
Sheriff, you knocked my fence over. You got a problem with that? Oh, no, Sheriff. No.
Yeah. Probably would have been like.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I don't think this is an off-road vehicle, by the way. I think it's
yeah.
No.
I'm gonna be in the like shop just... for a while.
Oh yeah.
This is such good action though. Like just random dude steals a motorcycle and he's like world class driver.
Mm-hmm. Even once again, just like yeah. Like big up to the location scouts for finding all of this place right. to have all of this happen. It's incredible.
Right.
Cause it creates such an interesting dynamic where it's I guess you have the forest so you can emulate, you know, Vietnam. And then after that, you still have the rocky areas to let you know that it's still in America, you know, just that reminder. Right. And then right. it's just really, really interesting to see how they found this place.
Agreed. And the fog that hangs around the mountain just makes it so ominous. It's always like hanging out mm-hmm. in the background of the first like 15 minutes of the movie. You know, like it becomes a character itself because he uses the terrain and
it's so primal, you know. Yeah. And there's a juxtaposition between he escapes to the wilderness because he's trained to live there. Right. He's mm-hmm. like wild. And then in town, yeah. he can't really function because it's, you know, all rules and, you know.
Right.
But once he gets out in the wilderness, he's just fine.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah. Man, British Columbia, Canada. Hope. Yeah, the place was actually called Hope. In real life. It's pretty interesting. Yeah, Hope, British Columbia. I wonder what it looks like today. Probably doesn't look the same at all.
Yeah, probably not.
Probably a bunch of big box stores and
mm-hmm.
stuff like that.
Was British Columbia where all those wildfires were? I don't know. I don't know the Canadian geography very well.
Yeah, me neither, man.
Yeah. British Columbia is like Vancouver, Pacific Northwest.
Oh, okay. So it was the opposite side of Canada.
Gotcha. Yeah, that was the Quebec that had all mm-hmm. that.
Right.
Gotcha. Thank you, by the way. Clearing that up. So they basically went from Washington and just drove up about 4 or 5 hours and just filmed there.
Yeah.
I like the way it shows you can, him scavenging
yeah,
stuff.
Right. Yeah.
He's always looking for the opportunity.
Yep.
Very first thing he looks for a canvas.
Right. Which becomes useful later down the road too.
Yeah.
Again, in a different
way.
I love his little
Because the first thing he grabbed was the rope. That piece of twine that was hanging up in the archway.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just getting everything ready. So, you know, preparing his inventory for the battle, I guess you could say.
Yeah.
First things first, shelter,
mm-hmm.
food, water. Well, water first, I guess. He doesn't really need food yet. He gets that later.
I mean, somebody that's trained like that to survive in the wilderness, they would be gone like Bigfoot.
Yep. Right.
Yep.
Exactly.
Especially British Columbia.
Yeah. You know what, the only reason they find him is because he wants to be found, I guess, you know.
Yeah. He comes back to town like a Roman says. It's his biggest error. He went back.
Yeah.
He escaped, you know. They thought he was dead. He could have just been gone. They never would have found his body and that would have been it. But no, it wasn't over. The mission wasn't over.
Exactly.
Yeah, it became personal. Because he came out, well, he hasn't done it yet. There's a certain point in the movie where it becomes super personal to John. Because at this point, he's just running because he doesn't, you know, he flipped out. And now he's like, oh, crap. Oh, crap. Yeah. Right?
Yeah, he realized what he did. And then he was like, oh, nope. Right. Well, I can't go back now. Especially with these people who are very inconsiderate. like already. You can't just go and justify yourself and be like, oh yeah, I had a PTSD attack, and they'll be like, we don't care. You know, you're going to jail. Right. That's it.
Right.
And he wasn't that far gone from that deputy when the deputy was out there shooting in the middle of the street. So I guarantee you he heard that shot.
Mm-hmm.
He knows they're coming for him. He knows they're shooting.
Yeah.
Which so limits his possibilities.
Okay.
Hey, Moira.
Well, I think the thing that made it personal is they shot a rocket launcher at him. I mean, come on. It's a bit overkill. Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That cannot be left unchallenged. Unanswered.
Incredible, yeah.
Yeah, the way they did the perspectives in this part, where he went from climbing up the screen to down to the side. Yeah, mm-hmm. It's so great. I love the way they did that. He loses him here in the forest, and like the way that the camera follows him through the forest, it's like you're losing where he's at too.
Yep. It's like awesome. It's up to you and your eyes to see if you can spot him there.
Right.
It's really, really great.
It's so good.
But you get a good idea of, you know, especially he's on the edge of the cliff, just how high up they are, you know, when the terrain is so mountainous.
Mm. Yep.
It's so good.
It's just like, again, just showing you, I guess it's really, really showing and not telling and just leaving it to the audience to understand that he is this much better than these people. He is this much trained than these people because he's able to get to these places. Like even, for example, just after this is where he's on the ridge. He manages to get on the ridge with his bare hands while they need a chopper. That just tells you, you know. It's like the Omni-Man meme, you know. It's like, see what they need to mimic a fraction of our power. It's like, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and this is these people's backyard. This isn't like some random mountain. This is like, we went here last year. Yeah, I got a buck right up there on the corner.
Uh-huh.
Like, these people know this place and still can't do anything to stop this guy. This is completely alien to John, and he just doesn't care. It doesn't matter.
That's his training. Take advantage of terrain.
That's right. He goes up higher ground.
Yep.
Yep.
Man, once again, just the locations. Really, really good. I mean, I guess today you'd rarely see them take a lot of effort, especially for a low budget. What this was made for, I think, $15 million at the time. It's very, very interesting, like, to see what they could have accomplished with $15 million back then compared to what they'd accomplished with, I guess, $15 million now. This would probably be a $200 million movie, and they probably wouldn't even have gone outside for more than 10 minutes.
Right.
Yeah. Green screen. Plus,
hanging off a cliff.
Like you're saying, you know, they show, they don't tell.
Exactly. Today,
there'd be like a running monologue of every single thing he's doing.
Right.
Explain to the audience.
Yeah.
Like, no, we don't need that. We just see what he's doing. We figure it out.
Yeah.
He would have been searching through that junkyard like, oh, I'm cold. I need some clothes. Oh, this will work.
Yeah.
Right.
And then you have this is great.
A huge speech by Trotman. He'd be like, yes, he wasn't a light killer. And then there you go. Right. They show the flashback. He's like, he's done this, and that. He can do this. And it's like, oh, come on, man.
Whenever he gets in trouble, there's a flashback of his mom teaching him how to do something.
Yeah.
Man, movies today are so predictable, man.
Right?
God, I know.
Man, that's so beautiful, though. Man, the land out here.
Too. Oh, yeah, it is.
Oh, the tree. That'll be coming in later.
Right? The tree. Chekhov's branch.
Yeah.
Being out there, being hunted by dogs.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, that's the worst part, too. It's like he's being hunted by dogs, and you can see that he's had the training to, get away from that. It's really, really, really to just emphasize constantly every opportunity that they have. It's like, yep. There it is. You know, show. And once again, as we were saying before about the cold, seeing every single breath he takes, just smoke.
Right. Mm-hmm. Which means that rock he's holding onto is basically a giant ice cube.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. Like as if it wasn't hard enough already.
All the body heat,
right? And he said there, the helicopter's having a hard time and through here because of the wind, which means it's also super windy up there too.
Wind chill. Yep.
Yikes.
Yeah. Dude.
Now this is crazy. He's clearly unarmed. He's on the side of a cliff. Right. He's not going.
Well, he's not unarmed. He's got a knife.
Yeah. Well.
But okay, yeah.
Fine.
Yeah, I'm with you. Yeah. I'm with you.
And this guy just like aims up and starts shooting him. Like, no, bro, come on.
Yeah, you shouldn't be doing stuff like that. And even then, you know, it's like, yeah, you know the risk, and it's just like, yeah, there it is. The risk is there, but you just don't care. It just shows the amount of hubris that these guys have.
Yeah.
And then he threatens the helicopter pilot. Like.
Yeah, and the fact that they also like emphasize on showing his face, because sometimes you wouldn't even realize that he's that hurt if you see him shooting from the helicopter, but they just have this scene where you see his face and you understand why he's so, I guess, adamant to attack and kill Stallone in the scene. You're like, all right, so it's personal for him. That's pretty much it.
Well, at a certain point, it's got to be, well, I've already done this. Now I have to finish it.
Mm-hmm.
So that the guy that I'm shooting at doesn't report me, you know, because he understands of what's going to happen. He's a law guy.
Yeah, exactly.
Right. But
he knows that this dude has rights, and like especially the level at which they've brought out huge resources like a chopper and everything like that. You know, you have to own up to someone. Yeah, exactly.
Yep.
Man, the cojones on that guy.
That just hurts
looking at it,
dude.
Yeah. So do you think you guys think that they were wired at the minimum, or it's just like free fall? That was it.
Well, the shots are pretty close on it. Probably wired, I guess.
Yeah. And this one probably wired.
I'd say so. Yeah.
I don't think the jump off the cliff was. I think that was a bag.
No, that was a bag. Yeah, he was free.
That was definitely a bag.
But this, wow, and the yelp that he lets out when he lands on the ground, super believable. He's Jesus, crushed ribs, crushed arm, like it's all right.
Yep.
Yeah,
100%, dude. At least it's real, because they what they do, it would be it's they really show that he can actually take damage. He is an indestructible I guess he's an indestructible force compared to the officers, but to nature himself, he's still like very vulnerable.
Right.
Yes, yes. Yeah, Sammy's right. This whole thing would just be like, you know, just jump cut, jump cut, jump cut, jump cut.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This, right here, where he uses nature against machine here, and nature comes out on top.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Brilliant. Brilliant. What? Best use of a rock ever.
Incredible.
Yeah,
man. And on shots like this, whenever you have someone falling a huge distance, you can always see them flailing their arms and legs a bit, you know, just to show you that it's an actual person that did this. We didn't just throw a rag doll down.
Right.
Down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Look at his body, how it's steaming, because it's all been busted up. His guts are steaming. But out.
One thing about that too, you have to disguise the waving of your arms. It's to control your fall, but you have to disguise that to make it look like you're just falling.
Right. Yeah, because they have to land on their back most of the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Almost all the time. Yeah. Not every time.
Yeah.
But this right here.
90% of the time.
Very modern video game. Kill the dude, loot the body.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And he looks at him in the face first, though. Like, what? What you were saying, buddy?
Exactly.
What?
Yeah, it's like this is exactly like he makes sure to tell him face to face, this is your fault. Yeah.
Right.
This wouldn't have happened if you didn't do what you did. That was it.
Yep.
This is the moment when I was talking about earlier, where it becomes personal, because he comes out like, "Hey, I didn't do anything. I don't want anybody to get hurt. You know, I'm standing here. Here I am." I don't want anybody else to get hurt. dude was trying to kill me.
Right. One of his people are dead, so now, you know.
Yep, personal to his.
He's got to pay.
Yep.
Yeah, everything they've done, everything the police have done in this have escalated the situation.
Yes.
Yeah, every single
time. Everything. Yep.
Yeah, they should have brought some social workers out.
Yeah, that would work.
Negotiator, man. Just get a negotiator at this point, at least, you know, try and talk him out of it. But everyone is out for blood now. That's the interesting thing, you know. They drew first blood. There it is.
Say that guy's on his way to Fort Bragg right now.
This is that part.
Yeah,
that was so good.
I was impressed.
I don't know how they did that, but it looks real.
And the blood
it's the whole probably a fake arm with his arm underneath it.
Yeah.
And that thing coming out. Because it looks like he's going into the meat there.
It does.
Mm-hmm.
Really, really, really good too. Yeah. And I really think that it's like a patch that they had added.
Off screen, just pumping the blood out every few seconds.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Probably added a small patch because even when he flexes his bicep, you can still see that it is his arm, you know.
Right.
Really like to emphasize it. And even the fact that he's like a bit wet too, so you have the glow on the arm, so you can't really have a fake arm like that, you know.
Right.
Probably
the
flat piece.
The red blood is covering up the fake arm.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Very well done.
Yeah, and even just the color of the blood in this movie, man, really, really good. Because you look at a lot of 80s movies, have that fake blood that doesn't stand the test of time, sadly.
Yeah.
Oh, man. It has some horrible blood. Just look at the Romero Day of the Dead movies, man.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah.
The blood does not hold up in any of those movies whatsoever. The guts do, but the blood itself doesn't, you know?
Right. Yeah, that's hard to do, and blood is very specific.
Yeah, especially for the time, considering that like nowadays, I guess it would have looked good back then. But then if you port everything to digital, you upscale it to 4K, then you can really start to see how bad it was. That's the issue as well that we have today by upscaling
CGI movies. Blood.
Older technology was more forgiving on makeup and special effects.
Yeah, that's the thing too. Yeah. It's like all of this was way, way, way more forgiving back then because I guess it wasn't as detailed for the viewer when you're watching it at the cinema. Even home distribution just wasn't as detailed as today. Today you're watching stuff in full 4K Ultra HD. Yeah. Everything is looking crystal clear. Right. You can see the dude's nose hairs even, you know, that's how precise everything is.
I've seen that makeup. You can see right in the makeup where they, you know, right up in here where they applied the makeup. And it's you can see up their nostril and everything.
Yeah, makeup back then, like when you look at it today, oof, sometimes you're like, hey, this looks bad.
Right. Well, I'll take that bad old practical blood over the CGI blood any day.
No, 100%.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Like I could see maybe augmenting a shot here and there with it, but I don't know. I don't like the way the CGI blood looks. It's super obvious most of the time, and especially 100%. When they first started doing it.
Yes.
It's because when they started, they were kind of using, I guess, stock squibs. So it just really looks incredibly obvious too. It's
Make squibs. Make squibs great again. Yes, Jay. Exactly.
100%.
That's right.
I always champion for squibs, man. Always champion for squibs.
Yeah, like Commando and Total Recall. Yeah.
Yeah. Even we covered Hard Boiled on my channel not too long ago.
Oh yeah.
Hard Boiled is full of crazy squibs, man. Shotgun squibs, machine gun squibs, everything. It's like, yep.
People probably like, oh, loaded up, getting ready to act, you know, 50 pounds of squids on them.
Right. Yeah, it was like we were going frame by frame, and you can even see the like the explosion, the pack, the little fire that lights up as the pack explodes. It's like, I guess you can't do that today because well, they'd probably say it's a, I guess, a, it's a liability issue. The stunt people would get hurt, or I don't know, man. Too much paperwork like nowadays.
Right, like a pencil pusher thing, not a stuntman thing.
Exactly, you, yeah.
Right.
You remember Blade Runner, the part where the Zora is running through the mirrors? In the original mirror, she's actually holding the squib control in her hand. You can actually see it snaking up on one of them.
That's pretty cool.
No, I didn't pay attention to that. Yeah, I'll have to rewatch it.
And I like stuff like that. You see them little things like that.
Yeah, same.
It's like Halloween has a good, the first Halloween movie when Michael goes to break the window in the very beginning, you can see there's a wrench like in the, and it's sticking out of his.
That one, you can really, really see that one. I don't know how they even kept it in the movie. I was like, whoa, it's so obvious.
Wait, what? He has had a what sticking out of his hand?
A wrench.
A wrench.
Like a wrench.
A wrench. Really?
Yeah, a wrench. That he used, he hit the window with a wrench and broke the window.
It was supposed to just
be his hand that hit the window and broke it. But
you know, as a kid, I thought it was his hand was deformed after hitting the thing. But it's only when I was growing up and rewatching it that I saw that you could actually see the wrench. That's what deformed his hand. That was what was weird.
Right. But yeah, these guys don't like that their buddy just died. And I get that. Mm-hmm. I mean, I can completely understand both sides of the standoff here. Which I think is really good writing to have something like that. There's no clear-cut villain in this, but there is a bad guy.
Mm-hmm. He's standing there with blood all over his hands. Yeah. I didn't do nothing.
Right. literally called red-handed.
Oh, you've done plenty of something, buddy.
Right. At this point, yeah.
Yeah, and at this point,
the whole police. Course,
the sheriff and all the other deputies, did they see him jump out of the plane? Well, not jump out, but like get out of the plane and to them they just assume that he just killed him in cold blood. That's
right, because the body's right there. If he had walked up to the body and they had been up on top of the ridge, they probably would have just shot him.
I'm guessing
anyway. I mean,
yeah,
I don't know. So I think they showed up right after. This is right after.
Yep.
And they still light up in him.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Just once again, this location, man. Look at this shot. And great, great, great location. And even just the composition, man. The staging and blocking over here is just really, really good. Great direction.
Yeah, the one, like, little V of the sky that came through the quarry was right in the center state. Yeah. Oh, yeah. So well done. No, we missed it, man. We missed it.
No, we didn't go that obvious. We talked about steaming guts and body looting.
Yeah, I could even imagine just the the filming problems that you would have just like going on location, especially
getting all that equipment down there.
Yeah, get all the equipment. Also, think about just the daylight, you know? Is it rainy? Is it gonna be cloudy today? How would it fare for continuity as well? It's just a lot of stuff to factor in, which is why I don't think that they that they film outside anymore. It's just too much hassle, I guess.
This guy was in Miami Vice.
Really?
Yeah, he was like one of the other cop. There were like another pair of cops that were worked with.
Some tertiary characters or repeating tertiaries.
I remember him.
Right.
Yeah. Now they find out he's the Green Beret. Oops.
Yep.
Right. Oops.
Yeah. Oops.
Which it's getting... I do like.
And it's
good.
No, you're good, man. You go.
Oh, okay. So, I like how they build up the Green Beret as like being a, like almost like super soldier type.
Yeah.
Like they are badasses, but not like,
I mean,
I don't
compared to a sheriff deputy. Yeah.
True.
They might as well be.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, nobody knew what seals were back then, so.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I would imagine that you know, back even, you know, in the 80s and stuff like that, or when this movie is set, it's, you probably didn't have as much information as about the you know, the military corps as you do today, where it's just like very widespread. You know, well, you you allegedly know all the different branches of military, so
right.
But you know, yeah, back then it was like, oh yeah, this dude is just the best of the best. That's all you had to know. That was enough, especially it's coming like, back from Nam. It's like, oh yeah, this dude was
fresh out of the bush
there. Just the fact that he's back from Nam. It's getting dark, well, you know.
Right. Yeah, it's getting dark, and it's like, let's keep going, let's get him. It's like,
yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Dark, it's straight through the woods at night.
Come on.
Yeah, what could go wrong?
Yeah, right. What could go right would be.
Let's just basically go chase a dude that can hunt us like a wild animal, and let's see how it goes, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, this right here, actually, he's addressing that point right there. He has lost his mind with rage right now. He's going to get back the dude that killed one of his best friends, right?
Yeah.
He's like,
he's not thinking rationally.
Right. Look at him. Yeah, that's brutal.
What do you say? I was friends with this man while you're still on your mama's tit.
Or was wiping your your dad or something. Yeah.
But I do love how the sheriff's deputies take the time to put the little plastic on their hats. Because, you know, safety first, guys.
Yeah.
You wouldn't want to be wearing a wet hat while being murdered, right?
Ew, no. No.
Yeah.
Well, I suppose that that part hasn't started yet. They don't even know what they're walking into. Yeah, he does.
He knows they're coming for him, and he just lays traps for him.
There it is, the cool knife once again.
It's about to get messy.
Yep.
Yep.
Man, I couldn't even imagine getting stabbed by that. You're just done.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's done.
Yeah.
Rip through like shark teeth, man. Once you're pulling it out. Oof.
Yeah. Designed for sawing wood. Yeah, your body don't stand a chance against that.
No. I can imagine. Plus, it's big enough for it to go like straight through and through your thigh if someone decides to stab you. It's like, yep, done. Got your femoral artery. Boom. You're gone in like less than 2 minutes.
Which is actually a kind of a cool point that I'm glad you brought up, because he does all these attacks at these dudes and doesn't end any of them. And for it to be all of them lived like that had to have been because he did it on purpose, not because it was an accident, not because he just happened to put it in there that way. He knows your body well enough to where he can get you like that and disable your leg without hitting those.
100%. And I mean, for me, this entire sequence is very, very interesting, and the reason why I find it incredibly interesting is that Rambo, he kind of uses the traps that you've now come to learn are the traps that they used to use in Vietnam, you know, that the Vietnamese would use against Americans, these really ingenious traps. And so for me, it comes as a sort of role reversal for the audience, whereas through seeing and understanding like what he's doing, like through seeing what he's doing and through seeing the sheriff's experience and the cop's experience in being attacked by from all angles, just in the middle of the forest, you don't know where he's coming from. It's like, this is a way to show the audience that this is what Rambo first experienced when he was in Vietnam. You didn't know anything. You just appear in the forest. People would be coming at you. You wouldn't know where they would come from. I think it's a great role reversal. And I guess you could also make this as a horror movie. For example, if they only showed the perspective of the officers, this could have been a pure horror sequence 100%, where Rambo would be seen as the villain 100%, you know?
Yes.
It's very, very interesting.
He becomes a Viet Cong.
It would be like Predator. Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
He picks him apart one by one.
He takes out the three Dobermans and
Yeah, yeah. It's the whole I'm not trapped in here with you, you're trapped in here with me kind of thing.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Right. Right.
They're too stupid to know it.
Right. He gets them all so fast, too. Like, it's crazy.
Yeah, really, really fast.
And then he tells them all, this could have been, this could have gone down a whole different way. Right.
Mm-hmm.
More trivia here. This guy was in Babylon 5. He was Garibaldi's second.
Oh, yeah. Lou was his name. This character's name, Lou.
Yeah, Lou. Yep.
I remember him. Yeah.
Interesting.
He actually shoots one of his own people, and, too, because he gets spooked. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I got him. I got him. No. Yeah. No.
You got the wrong somebody. Right.
Just it's a random dude.
And Rambo also gets somebody in a trap where it makes him holler out for help.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And he gets the guys coming for help. That's good.
Just shows how efficient he is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because the first guy he gets, good old CSI boy, right in the leg, mm-hmm. and he just sits there screaming for him the whole time. Hey, come here, come here, come here!
And he's screaming over here, and then you hear somebody screaming over here. Uh-huh. So they don't know which way to go because everybody's screaming for help.
Yeah, so quick. It's like, and by that time, it's just traps that he's deploying. So he's probably taking out a third person that's screaming at another location, too.
Yep.
By the way, that part right there that we just went past was probably one of the only examples that I can think of where the main character kills a dog and isn't looked on as a bad guy for doing so.
Mm.
Right. That's true. Yeah.
Yeah.
That's like the opposite of the save the cat thing is to kill the dog.
Yeah, that's true.
In a lot of horror movies, people do that. They're like, John Wick made a whole series out of it, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's right. Whole thing got started because they killed his dog.
Right.
Yeah, maybe it's because, what's it called? It's like dog racial profiling. Maybe because it was like a Doberman, people don't care.
Right.
If it was like a German Shepherd, people would be up in arms.
Doberman lives matter. Come on.
Oh, yeah. I used to have a Doberman, man. Really cool dogs, man.
Paul's up, you know.
Were you beautiful?
Paul's up.
Yeah. Look at all that mist and everything, how lush it is, and you can't see anything.
Yeah,
the scenery itself. Just look at how tiny they are in comparison to the trees. It's great.
Yeah. Like the light. In this scene and in this whole like part here, it's just great because you can't really see their faces, but you can at the same time, like they're you can tell who is who and where they're going, but you can also tell it's also getting dark. Like, I've seen a lot of movies where you have to just pretend it's night, you know.
Yeah, because usually what they do is they use a day for night and then they're just shooting the day, put the filter over it, act as if it's nighttime. But the thing that gives it away is the shadows. Especially the intensity of the shadows. The Jordan Peele Alien movie, it did that. It gave it away automatically because of how strong the shadows were.
That one, where he was in the shot the whole time that dude was climbing over.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He made himself a little ghillie suit and.
Yeah. Brilliant.
Oh, yeah. There is. Man, it's also, you know, just for the aspect of seeing these people, it's like, they're wearing white hats, like, and it's there. It's like, it's there for you to be able to see them very, very clearly as well in the forest when it's getting dark.
Right.
And it's also to make you focus on the white hat so you don't see Rambo coming up.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Right. Like they're all freaking out. Man, there's two of us left. Should we keep going? Sure.
I love this. This is my favorite part here. I love this part.
It's like nobody ever looks up.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
That's just a
video game NPC.
That's a predator scene right there.
Right. Quick time event. Yeah. Like some Batman Arkham stuff, right?
Basically, they just never look up while you're. It's a stealth mission while you're on stealth. Right. You can just jump on them. Done.
Yep. Ouch.
There's another one.
Everybody's screaming.
Man, the pure terror that you would have at this point to not just run away. And even if you try and run away, like, he'd probably just chase after you.
Yeah, right. I know.
He planned for that too, I'm sure.
Here's my favorite, one of the best ones here. Yoink.
Got it.
See ya. Done.
Yeah. It's the last guy in the line. Nobody sees him again. You know, because.
Yeah.
Gone like a raptor in Jurassic Park, man. Whoop. Yeah. Taking him
and
away.
It was right as he looked away, too.
Yep.
So, like, right as you look away, you're not going to want to look right back again. You just look there, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So he's got a couple seconds, and during that section, see it.
Done.
And there didn't he is. Doing
tied up to a tree. Up.
Twice, two ties, one in the neck and one in the hands.
Yeah. Just to show how efficient he is as well. It's like, yeah, I had enough time to take out all of you guys and tie one of you up.
Right, and so, then hide.
Then hide, yes.
Oh, man. Yoink. See ya. That's it.
This is the point where it's like 100%.
Like, don't push it.
Completely outmatched. The sheriff himself is like, yeah, this is really where I see that the cops would be representing the U.S. troops in Vietnam when they first arrived. And, of course, you know, Rambo is like a Viet Cong at this point. And it's like, you guys wanted a war. It's like, I'm here for it. And you're going to suffer the consequences.
He brings it up later about how they wouldn't let him fight the war he needed to fight.
Mm-hmm.
But these people, this is their backyard, right? So if anything, like that, the Viet Cong were in their own backyard. So it was, like, the war didn't happen in some other place. It happened down the street at Johnny's house.
Yep.
You know what I mean? And that's where these guys are right now. So if anything, the cops are the Viet Cong in my mind. But I mean, I can see your point too.
Yeah.
I love this.
Yeah.
He's like, let it go. Let it go. Badass. Let it go. Because that's what the sheriff was thinking. I got my M16. We're gonna get him. It's like, nope. Totally switched.
Yeah, no chance, buddy.
And especially seeing like Stallone's performance here, when you have the comparative of Rocky that came out, what, I guess, eight years earlier at this point, 76, 82, six, and then so like to see the way that he just looks, just the acting through his eyes only, it's just enough to sell you of his performance. Really, right. Really good.
Mm-hmm. And that mark they left on his neck,
just a little nick there,
little scar.
He bled him a little. I like how he just slumps down him and when he looks in the mirror.
It's like a reminder. Every time he looks in the mirror, he'll remember. I messed up.
Green Beret bad.
Here's where he finally realizes the total error of his ways. He just got his ass handed to him. His men have been decimated. One guy's dead.
Right. And this town has no police force anymore.
Yeah, they all been taken basically. Out. That's why part of the National Guard and the State Police. They know local sheriffs left.
These National Guard guys, man. Oh, my God.
Man, they're the worst. Yeah, and as Jay mentions in the chat, it's like he collapses and cries, which is absolutely correct for the adrenaline. I could imagine your heart would have been pumping at that point. Then when he just pops out at you, it's like the final jump scare. It's too much at that point. And where it's just like, all right, well, I'm done, you know? I'm really, really done. But just, you know, the sheriff also as well just shows you how much, I guess, pride he has. Because he's gotten the warning. He's seen the capability of Rambo. But he's still willing to go after him just because, yeah, he wants to. You know, he needs to prove a point, I guess, to himself and, of course, to the townsfolk.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Well, and he predicts the rest of the movie here, the foreshadowing. Let it go or I'll give you a war.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't let it go.
Yep. Didn't want to let it go.
They should have let
it go. Right.
Yeah.
Only their skill and police training saved their lives. No.
Yeah.
No.
Right.
Police training didn't do anything.
Yeah.
I don't think they trained for this.
Only their skill and police training saved their lives.
Gotta love that. I'm surprised it doesn't say CNN on the side right there.
This is a mostly peaceful protest. Yeah. Right?
Yeah. It's a camping trip, man. They just needed to get some bread.
Yeah, like all of these guys are like bandaged up, really, really badly beaten.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, they got
the ones that can still walk. Yeah, yeah. Everyone's been carted off in ambulances and stretchers.
This is that guy at the beginning where he knocked him over and then smacked him in the face with his elbow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh man.
So he's got two black eyes and broken nose.
Broken arm and
right.
Yeah, Ezra finds out what happened. They hosed him down a little and messed him around and
yeah, and the statey there is like, you assholes.
Yeah.
He's right. Shouldn't do that. God didn't make him. I made him.
That was a great line.
Yeah, it was.
God didn't make Rambo. I did.
Just the way he says it too, it's just like very matter of fact. That's the interesting thing. He doesn't say it like a badass line, just says it matter of fact. It's like, yep,
right.
That's it.
You boys have no idea what you're up against here. Like, yeah, he's a Green Beret, but he's not just a Green Beret, okay?
It's John Rambo, ladies and gentlemen.
Right, Timothy Jones. This guy, right? This guy is the one.
Yep, he's him.
And this is cool because they use this a lot in modern films where they have the scene where they tell you about how badass the character is. Mm-hmm. But they have just got done setting up that all this stuff is true and plausible.
Exactly.
Right, where most modern movies don't do that.
Yeah, they would have either done it after this scene. I guess you'd have had this scene, and then, I mean, you know, if the writer of the modern movie is actually competent, you'd see the person using their competence, you know?
Right.
But most of the time, it'll just be like, oh, yeah, he can do this, that.
Right.
And it's like, all right, cool. And then you just never see it happen in the entire movie.
Right. Yeah, this is the guy that shows up and he's like, let me interpret for you what just happened. Mm-hmm. Because you guys have no idea what you just walked into. Yeah, I love it.
Copa, no.
Yeah. Yeah. Gross. Gross. Almost gagged a little there. That's good stuff, Copa.
You see, Copa, I had to mute myself because I was puking on the side.
Right.
Yeah. I recruited him, trained him, fought with him. I guess right. That makes him mine.
Yeah. Yeah. Shield Ball brings up a good point here, too.
Yeah. It would be a woman
doing
all this now.
It would be that character would be a black female lesbian.
Yep. Yeah. Exactly.
I'm telling you, Shield Wall, it would have been Jennifer Lawrence, man.
That's right.
She was the first action hero. Yeah, first female action hero, wasn't she?
That's right.
Yeah, that was what you said.
God. Yeah, it would be a girl. It would be a black woman named Burnham.
Yeah.
Oh, Mikey. Mikey Burnham.
Awesome. Yeah, what a cool character, though. Like, he doesn't do a whole lot as far as, like, proving that he's a badass, but the actor has a really good air of authority around him when he's speaking.
Yeah.
And he's got this, like, snide way of dealing with these guys, like, oh, okay, you don't want to believe me? Go find out for yourselves, right?
Yep.
Yeah. What a cool guy. He has gravitas.
Just make sure you have plenty of buddy bags.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah. I also like the fact that they bring him back for the beginning of the sequel.
Yeah.
I really, really like the conversation that he has. As much as I'm not a big fan of the sequels, I do like the first conversation that he has with Rambo at the beginning of First Blood Part 2, which right. I don't even think it should be called First Blood Part 2, because at that point it's not even First Blood, man. It's just...
Yeah, I didn't understand the naming convention.
Yeah, it's kind of weird.
Yeah. Yeah, because the third one is Rambo 3, but it really is Rambo 2 if Part 1 had two parts.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, exactly. So weird.
But it's all right.
Road Warrior right. and Mad Max, you know.
Yeah, right. That's true.
Titles.
Yeah, I do prefer the numbering, personally.
Yeah, because it's weird because in the 80s you had a lot of movies that had the like headers, like subheaders in terms of like subtitle. It's weird.
Yeah,
it's kind of like a yeah, exactly. It's so weird, man. Even look at Nightmare on Elm Street. You know, a lot of people mm-hmm. don't even say Nightmare on Elm Street 3 or 4. They're just like, oh, the Dream Warriors.
Yeah, exactly. This one,
or the Final Nightmare. It's like,
Dream
yeah.
Master.
Yeah. Exactly.
You know, Shredder does not like the Colonel much.
No, he does not. Well, understandably so. He comes in here. That guy is wholly responsible for making the guy who is wholly responsible for killing everybody he likes.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, actually, they're not dead. I'm sorry. He didn't kill them. He maimed all of them.
Yeah. Yeah. He embarrassed all of them, too.
Right. Oh, big time.
At this point, how do you even, you know, as the sheriff and as all the deputies, how would you even justify yourself to the townsfolk? It's like, yeah, this one dude took care of all of us in the woods and managed to wreak havoc in the entire town. And it's not even as if he's wreaked havoc yet in the town, you know?
There's no shame involved in getting your butt kicked by this guy, man. That's like saying, you know, Captain America came in town and just beat up everybody in town. And yeah, I got beat up too, you know? Like, well, yeah, it was freaking John Rambo, dude.
Yeah, and it's like, it's kind of their way of showing the, it's like, how do you, as a small sheriff, like small town sheriff, where word travels very, very fast, how would you live knowing that if you go to a diner and you're eating, I guess you can hear someone whispering in the corner, oh, yeah, he got his ass beat by some random dude that you know, popped into town. It's like, some how could you live with that? Especially seeing the amount of like hubris that this dude has,
right?
Yeah, I don't like his re-election.
Rambo doing a little hunting.
Yeah, little light spear hunting. Like that hide is tough, man. That's what the guys on Forged in Steel, is that what it's called? Forged in Fire. They use those carcasses to test blades' durability. Like that's no joke. What he just did right there.
So I always wonder why he killed the pig if he already had two dogs he could eat.
Agreed. No, seriously. They were talking about he'll eat anything. He had already killed the dogs. Maybe he had to leave them behind.
I think it's for the audience.
He already ate the dogs. I mean, come on.
Yeah, they were kind of smallish.
Needs a lot of protein. Yeah,
he needs protein.
Yeah, you're right. It's for the audiences showing that he's, you know, a survival, you know.
Right.
Eat off the land and hunt and...
Maybe he buried the dogs. He had respect for him. He didn't want to kill him, but they were coming for him.
Yeah, well, I mean, even then, it's for the audience where it's like, would you still connect with John Rambo if you saw him taking the dogs to go and eat them?
Yeah. No, that's true.
Exactly.
Peak would be like, oh, no.
True.
Savage.
It was bad enough that he already killed the dog, right? Like, that's right on the line. We'll let it slide, though, because of the situation. Which is weird, because most of the time, I feel the opposite way.
Yeah.
The shark in Jaws killed a kid and a dog in the same scene.
Yep. No.
Yeah.
It's a good way to establish a villain, man.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
True.
Yeah. It's all starting to sink into him. He's like, man, I don't care what you guys are saying. I'm going after this guy either way, but really, never tell me the odds, right?
We got 200 men. We got copters. He's only one guy.
Yeah, it's just one. I'm sure it'll be fine.
Exactly. Just put it in perspective of how crazy powerful this one dude is.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. The National Guard of your state probably would have had a better chance if they had spent more money on training your National Guard.
I was going to say the National Guard here seems to be pretty woofily underprepared.
Right.
I mean, you
feel like,
depending on how much your state.
Let's say they'd have a better shot if they just started training right now.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, right.
Back then, the National Guard is where you went to if you didn't want to go to Vietnam.
Right.
Because they didn't send those guys back then.
Right.
Right.
You know, last two wars, the National Guard was just part of the army.
Mm. Yeah, and they bring it up, too. Like, he starts talking, he's like, I didn't sign up to get killed, dude.
Yeah. I just do this on weekends. Yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
And the chain of command in there is crazy. You can tell the difference here. Like, they don't respect their commanding officer in any kind of way at all, but John Rambo does.
Yeah, yeah. Right, they know the guy who's their lieutenant. And they're like, no, I ain't doing it, Bob. You know.
Right. Right. It's so crazy. I love this. These three players right here, the Stady, the Sheriff, and the Colonel, they play really well off each other, even though it's real short. Like, the Stady doesn't say a whole lot. I don't even remember his character's name.
Mm.
But that dynamic where they're going back and forth like that, that's really, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, so it's all really, really interesting, because this is where it's kind of the breather moment for the audience, and even for the characters in the movie. It's like, yep, this is the time where we're just relaxing, trying to recoup, you know, everything that we have, trying to get our forces back in shape and getting a game plan. But at the same time, John Rambo's also getting that time to adapt and make him his own game plan, of course.
Regroup, rest, eat something.
Mm-hmm. It's crazy because, like, they'd be regrouping, resting, eating, while John Rambo is just preparing. That's it, you know? It's a completely different dynamic. Two worlds apart.
Well, I'd have to agree with what Shieldball said there. I think all them National Guard guys came from the very local area because they all know the sheriff. The sheriff addresses them by name.
Mm.
Like, everybody knows, hey, I got to be back at the drugstore on Monday. It's like the drugstore, like the one
that we had. Yeah, the one where you could just see drugs written everywhere.
Right. I think it was Scott's Drugs or something like that. Yeah. I mean, they show it in the beginning. He walks right past it in the opening shot. But they show like a pan of the whole town. It's pretty cool.
This is kind of crazy because he's in this cave and you hear that wind howling. And then you hear the radio, you know, the call signs from Vietnam. He probably think he's having a nightmare again.
Well, he's in a dark place. Like the way they set up the shot and everything. The character is metaphorically in a dark place. And probably regretting what happened, having, you know, the post adrenaline come down and thinking about what you just did and thinking of the ramifications, making plans of where he's going to go. Like, who knows how far gone he is at this point? He seems to be acting rationally, pulling punches and stuff. So it's not like he's fully gone.
Yeah. But
he's not all right, you know?
It's like he won't break radio silence. You know, he's there. He's listening. He's listening, but, you know, like.
Right. And his name, Raven.
Yeah,
the harbinger of death, Raven. Yeah. Yeah, that's
just
really
proves
cool.
how crazy and powerful the dude is in comparison to everyone. Everyone just seems completely outmatched. And even Troutman, he kind of seems scared of Rambo himself.
Right. I got that sense too that he knew what he was fully capable of, and.
I think one at a certain point.
Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, at a certain point, his reputation becomes a weapon too. You know.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah.
Sorry. Go ahead, Jake.
I see it like Halo, when Master Chief walks into the room, and all these regular dudes just look up because he's taller than they are. That's Rambo.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, he's that different.
Yeah. It's a force of nature.
Yeah.
Yep. It's kind of sad how he calls out all the names of the team, but then Rambo has to come back. They're all dead, you know?
Yeah.
Like, all these other people are now dead.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he just got done going on his journey. You know, find I like all what his he, old buddies.
I like what he said when, what's his name? His commanding officer guy says, not what's his name? He made it back. And he's like, he died in Vietnam. He just didn't know it.
Mm. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. Just like, it's a very, very, I think it's the scene where, as much as they've already humanized Rambo, they just humanize him even more just for the audience to just be like, this is very, very hard on him, you know, just to emphasize that.
Yeah.
Then there Sorry he is,
about man. The dog noises.
It's a cute dog, man. That's okay. What type of dog is it?
Full-blood Chihuahua.
Nice.
Yeah, she's a little tiny thing. She's about 2 pounds.
Yeah, dude, I grew up with 8 dogs oh, wow. when I was a kid, so I know dogs, it's, man.
Yeah, she's a lap dog. She's super lovable.
Like, dude, I had a Doberman, a German Shepherd, and then they made babies, and then it was like, yeah, just mixed breed.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, huge dogs.
Sorry, I didn't mean to derail stuff. Sorry about that.
No, that's okay. That's all right.
Yeah, all this conversation
had, growing up were mixed dogs.
Oh, nice. What kind?
Yeah.
Yes, he's telling him the mission's over, the war's over, come home, you know, you got to come in. And he's like, no.
Yeah, this is
never over.
That was a Collie Sheltie mix.
Oh, nice.
Another one was a Rottweiler Collie mix.
Oh, nice.
So it was a Rottweiler with long hair.
Yeah, I'll bet that was pretty, dude. I'll bet that was cool looking.
Yeah, it was. Yeah. I'll send you a picture of him. Later.
Nice. Please do. Oh, by the way, her name is Athena.
Yeah.
Athena. Nice. Yeah, you should get another dog. Just call him Kratos, bro.
Right. I just had a male cat. I was gonna name the male cat Ares, but the kids ended up naming him Tom and it stuck.
Oh.
But we do have a cat named Artemis.
No, that's nice. That's nice.
Yeah, she's cool with that.
There you go. Yeah, I like this part. He's like, they drew first blood.
Yeah.
What do you say? Cinematography is also great on this scene. You know, the lighting in the dark, especially. Really, really good.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, he was talking about civilians here. Like something like there's no non-aggressive civilians or something like that. Like that's powerful, man. I never really thought about that. He wants to go back to the bush because at least he knows all the people around him got his back. Nobody's got his back out here at all. And all the people who did are all dead. This guy's got nothing. And then they attacked him. So now he's backed into a corner with nothing to lose. This is a dangerous man.
Yeah, because Troutman says that the only thing that's close, the only thing that's equivalent to family to him is like Troutman. That's it. And even then, he doesn't know if he'll be able to stop Rambo.
Right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's like, at this point, this guy really doesn't have anything to lose whatsoever. He's just, he's just there. You know, he's ready to die probably and take out everyone with him.
Yeah. He has no hope. He has a future. He has a life. Mm-hmm. You know?
It's just a drifter, you know, as they say.
The survivor guilt on top of all that other stuff, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, interestingly enough, you know, it's kind of like the sheriff was right in a sense where he did bring trouble to the town, but
certainly. Yeah, he was completely right for the wrong reasons.
Exactly.
But correct. Yeah.
Yeah. He's a Rambo's a drifter with nothing to lose.
Mm-hmm. Right. He's like, next drifter that comes through town, I'm just going to shoot him.
Yeah. At this point, yeah.
Right. I'm not taking any chances.
They'll set up like a checkpoint on the outskirts of town, man. Right. Check it, everyone. Be like, all right.
Yeah, these guys. Yeah. Good luck, buddies. I'm sure that helmet will help.
Man, these are the regular dudes, man. Just the dude from the drugstores. Like, all right,
yeah, weekend warriors,
right? Mm-hmm. What is that? E5, E1? I don't know how the works. It's the lowest of the low, like privates and corporals out here with one lieutenant, right? Maybe one sergeant. Like, probably, I don't know how the specifics of the military stuff works. I don't know.
It's probably just I mean, even, you know, just having this kid out here on it just seems to me like they're all volunteers. That's it, just all of them, just random volunteers.
Yeah. he thought about it too. He's like, he knows that this kid was going to give away his position.
Mm-hmm.
He thought about it right there. He's like, man, no.
As soon as the kid pops up, he's like, dad, dad.
Right.
He's over there, over there. Yep, yeah, we see him, we see him. Then they start shooting directly. Mm-hmm. You know, I would have knocked the kid out, to be honest.
Me too.
Which is something.
I would have taken his gun, like, certainly.
This is the sheriff. This is totally irresponsible to get all these people from the town out there to hunt him down.
He's got a posse, you know, and everybody's just shooting first.
Yeah.
Well, him not doing anything to that kid right there is one of the reasons why we're still rooting for this guy.
Yep.
Like, seriously.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's true. Yeah. Because, I mean, if he had the dogs, we wouldn't be rooting for him. If he killed the kid, we wouldn't be rooting for him.
Right. Well, and if he ate the kid, then it would be even worse.
Yeah.
He needed the extra protein, man.
It's cold out there. Got to keep the body going.
That's right.
Yeah, and I mean, just even the sheriff, it just shows you how desperate he is in this situation, because he knows how dangerous John Rambo is. His entire team was wiped out, man, and they're trained. These guys aren't trained; they're regular people, you know. So, the fact that he still sends them out there, very, very, very interesting.
Sorry, my little man went to bed there.
Yeah, these guys. Oh. I love this. They're shooting at him, and he does one little spray with his M16, right. And they're like,
and they're done.
I'm not going over there. Are you crazy? I'm done.
It's the way they're just lying down on the ground too. They're not even lying like flat on their stomach, just flat on their backs. Like, nope, I'm not moving. It's done.
When I first saw the scene, I thought he had got the guys, and it turns out they were just scared. Like, nope. Sorry.
I like the military. The military tactician here. You two, you go in there. No.
No. I'm not doing
like,
that.
Do that yourself, man. Like, then he looks on the other side. He's like, you go in there. No.
Right?
No.
It's understandable.
Come on, guys. We got to do something.
Oh, man. Weekend warriors, I know. As you guys said.
Yeah, yep. That's what they were.
It's them.
Yeah.
One week in a month, 2 weeks a year. That's the deal for the guard.
Yeah. They get to tell all their friends.
Right. Yeah.
Captain Clinton Morgan.
Well, I mean, I suppose it's better training than not going.
Yeah. I mean,
it's not like they're doing nothing. They're not teaching them how to weed baskets or something in the National Guard.
Yeah, these guys are not meant to.
This guy's like, yeah, go ahead and shoot him. Just let me get out of the way.
Yeah, they may have the training, but they don't have the heart. You know, that's right. The issue.
It's true.
No,
but this guy,
the courage.
I don't blame him at all.
Like, oh, for sure.
When am I ever going to get a chance to shoot this at anything ever? I'm doing it now. I'm just going to do it.
Yeah, right.
And then they like cut to him at the end, and he's like, yeah.
It's like, yeah.
Wow.
Boom.
That's a cool shot.
A really, really cool explosion.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Way too much flame.
Mm-hmm.
Well, right.
Right.
Unless they hit some fuel to flame all that fire, but
right.
Yeah, and even then, cool. That becomes relevant later because you know he finds fuel in down in the caves as well. So it's like, yep.
Yeah.
But he was looking for fuel in that stuff earlier, was he not? Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's all empty out there.
Remember when movies were written well?
Yeah.
So yeah.
Love this. That explosion.
Yeah, it's like like typical movie explosion, way too much fire. It's like a movie grenade explosion. A grenade never worked the way they do in movies.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Maybe flashbangs.
Yeah, movie. Movie hand grenades are atomic hand grenades.
You know, right?
Right.
It's about a 50-gallon drum of gas attached to him.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
And there it is again. just like good shots of helicopters with your actors, and it's like, oh man, you don't see this anywhere, anywhere today.
Yep. Well, those helicopter shots probably cost them a good million or more.
Oh yeah, for sure.
Oh, they they're not cheap.
I remember those back
three helicopter scenes were probably the most expensive of the movie.
Oh yeah, for sure. Especially considering the weather and
three,
all
three
of
different
that,
helicopters too.
Yeah.
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 I mean, you hear maybe the in movies station. They reuse one helicopter for all the shots, but this was like this three different helicopters.
Yeah. And then remember back in the back in the 80s when they could make a movie and have like three helicopters straight downtown, just going. It was like, yeah, we shut down downtown today for what? Yeah, we just have a few helicopters running through with a bunch of guns strapped to them. All right, cool. Today it's like, no. You CGI, man.
Right.
We'll fix it. We'll fix it in opt. You know, we'll fix it post. Afterwards.
Fix it in post.
In post. Yeah, there we go.
Yeah. It's like, damn it, you were supposed to stand down and wait for me to get here. The guy's like, but he was shooting at us. Go away.
Of course, we use a rocket launcher.
But I gotta work. You better clean. I love it. He's like, you better clean this up. He's like, I gotta work tomorrow. Well, you better clean it up fast.
Right.
He just throws his helmet down on the ground. Damn it. It's like, all
right. Right.
Man.
Well, that's what happens when you're in charge, man.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. Take responsibility.
That's right.
It's crazy because, like, it's just that, again, you guys have a bunch of guns. This dude has one gun. You guys can all shoot at the same time, and he'll probably cut and run because he's still human. You know, he can't like dodge bullets or anything. But he just decides to end it with a rocket launcher. Yeah, except for that one scene
where he does dodge bullets.
But then it's like, yeah, but you're just like, yeah, let's use the rocket launcher. Why not? Because we can. All right.
Yeah. Good thing he like started running a half a second before that thing hit. He might have gotten hurt.
Yeah.
Yeah,
dead
for sure.
But they think he's gone, and they're like finishing everything up, and he could have just left.
Mm-hmm.
Because it took him more than a day of doing what he is doing right now.
Yep,
he was down in there for more than a full day.
And yeah,
you can tell that because of the scenes that happen in between.
Yeah, because even with the lighting, because this is at the butt crack of dawn, basically. And then the next time we see him is in the dead of night when everything. I think it's not when everything is closing, but when people are basically just doing their stuff at night, like going out and enjoying and stuff like that. It's like, yeah, this dude was down there in the dumps for a while preparing for this.
Right. And I couldn't imagine that. And the way that they shot the scenes of him where he is, it seems to be very claustrophobic, even in a widescreen format. Yep. Like it's very closed in, super well done. I love the way they did that.
You get the feeling that he's really trapped in a mine shaft that's collapsed on him.
Right. And alien enough, to him.
Yeah. And like, weirdly enough, they don't really do scenes like that anymore. At that level, because for example, you look at something like I think it's The Last Crusade. You see, they have the crypt scene where they go in there with all the rats and stuff like that. It's like you can tell that they actually put real rats there. You can tell that they built the set specifically to flood it so that they can do this. Nowadays, you don't really see that. I think the last time I personally remember seeing them build something like that. At a huge level was for the Stephen King It adaptation, the first one. They build the sewers. They actually built the sewers practically in a huge warehouse to be able to film those claustrophobic scenes. And that was a while ago too. But since then, I personally haven't seen any films that have had this level of practical, especially for claustrophobic spaces, which I think is. It's pretty sad, it's becoming a lost art,
yeah. They had a full-on rat wrangler in the credits for this movie.
The rats probably had names too.
And they had a dog person, and they had a full just an animal person.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah.
Oh yeah.
So well done.
Just here having your actors hold a lamp, a torch like this, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's so cool.
Now it would be CGI rats.
That'd be it'd be a cell phone light, you know.
Mm.
CGI cave.
Yes, CGI rats, especially because I'm sure the producers would be like, oh, is it easier to just do it in post where they can animate it the way we want? Or is it easier to get a rat wrangler and spend your entire day trying to wrangle 500 rats, you know?
Right.
Mm-hmm.
They'd easily go for CGI.
Look at him.
Even though it doesn't look the same way.
Yeah,
the sheriff.
He's had a hell of a day.
Broken, worn out, defeated.
Yep.
Didn't get to kill the guy.
But he won. Entire
budget is gone for the year.
Right. Right. There'd be a severe shortage of crutches in this town.
Well, I'm not getting reelected.
Right. I'm not getting the Christmas bonus.
I think their budget might go up next year, though. Like, we have need of it, seriously.
Damn, look at the cave, man.
Yeah,
really, really good.
Oh, man.
It's a real flame that he's holding, too, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. There.
Yeah.
And then standing in real water, which means it was super cold. Super cold. Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. On set, it was probably freezing.
Right. In this part. No, I'm good on that.
Rats in the pants.
Yeah, the rats. No. Rats crawling on you?
I think I'd rather have rats crawling on me than spiders.
Yeah, this part.
Me too.
This part, too. I mean, he's actually wrapping it while the flame's on. You know, so that's actually him doing that.
And by the way, I think Shield Ball's right there. I agree. Completely.
Yeah, Dennehy was not, his character was not a noob.
Right.
He just really underestimated the situation, misread it completely.
No.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's why I like.
In the book, he was, I think we already said this, but in the book, he was in Korea and Rambo was in Vietnam.
Right.
Yeah, because it's very, very weird because like that to me would kind of be my only fault of the movie, of them not understanding that he's having a PTSD episode, considering that they have service, they have years of service. That to me it just seems as kind of I guess you could say it was a plot hole. But
this is an extended issue. PTSD though. If this was extended PTSD, all those people would be dead.
Oh, yeah. Oh, 100%.
Like he's in control of what he's doing. He's measured and making good decisions and like using his training and stuff. But I don't think he's gone. I think he's in a bad spot, and I think that there's some screws loose, but I don't think that this is PTSD.
Oh, yeah.
It was. Sure.
Yeah, it was.
Yeah.
Exactly. Right. Like for me, it's the fact that it was, and they didn't really realize it. That's the big issue that I have with the movie. But I think I can still, suspend my disbelief just because of how hubris the cops are shown to be.
Right. And the like they notice his scarring and then a couple minutes later do the same kind of torturing that would cause scarring and threaten him with a blade and hold him down. And I mean, what they think was going to happen. He was just going to be like, oh, okay, go ahead. No. That's not what they train you to do in the military. So I would imagine anybody in that situation for the military would have resisted at least a little, try to save himself, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But Jay, you do make a good point. I think it is a comparison of how, differently the wars that they fought in were. Because we know the Vietnam War was something else for the U.S. troops, man. It's really, really something.
Yeah.
Especially the ones that were conscripted.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
I can't imagine those people, pulling their name on a card.
done. Like, yeah, your life has changed, dude. It's like the equivalent of World War One at that point, where you're just like, yep, you're going in there. You don't really know what you're gonna face. You think it's gonna be a quick in and out job, but nope, you're in for a literal nightmare.
Yeah,
long haul. Yep.
Yeah, and he's just sitting here in mourning for his, you know, for his servicemen. Man, yeah, he was the best, right?
It's interesting because he does have this this air of 100% knowing that Rambo is alive, but there's also the fact that the chief, like the sheriff here, for example, like he kind of says, now that to him it's all said and done, he's kind of like, oh, you know what? I may have overreacted. It's like, dude, come on, man.
Maybe, you think?
You think?
Maybe?
Maybe a little.
Yeah, it's crazy.
But yeah, that whole, I hope he's still alive, and probably he's still alive, but there is a chance he's dead. So I'm going to act like he's dead so he can get away, because that would be the smart move, is to leave.
Yep. Yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
Then he still stays there, you know, just... Yep, he still stays there just in case. Just in case.
Well, and he's adding a cover story for him at this point. Yeah, he's gone. Let's take a drink for him, right? And at the end of the movie, he even brings it up how he's covered his butt more than once. This is an example of him doing it on screen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally agree.
It's such just a well-written, nuanced character.
Yeah, it's a great conversation as well. It's really, really, really good.
And like you said, he doesn't do a lot, but when he's there, he adds to the scene.
Yep.
You know.
And then the juxtaposition from them sitting in comfort, drinking and talking, over to this suffering. Yeah, he's
crawling around the bowels of the earth trying to...
Right. Dante's Inferno-esque hole he's in.
Mm-hmm. Dude.
Light at the end of the tunnel.
Yeah. Yes. And air.
Fresh air. Yeah, fresh smell. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's actually a good point, because probably just been breathing in weird fumes at this point since he's been down there.
Yeah.
Right. Down in those little tiny spaces with a torch. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oof. Finally, real oxygen.
Right,
and he's still hurt through all of this. Yeah. Just DIY,
that right there.
Yeah,
that scene right there where he's crawling up out of the hole. That was, I was talking about that earlier, where the music, it reminds me a lot of the music from Predator.
Mm-hmm.
It's very similar, and wow, so well done, man. The music in this, like, I can't believe we made it this far without talking about the music. Like, it's so good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, music is really, really good too. And you know, considering how thinly stretched Jerry Goldsmith was at that time, I'm surprised that he still managed to make very unique compositions for each of the movies that he was in.
Agreed. You know,
like he was tasked to do. Yeah. Very interesting.
It's almost like the list of stuff he didn't do is shorter than the list of stuff he did.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah. Really, 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 like, there. And even its usage in the movie, I think it's really good, because it's not used too much, but it's just used there to accompany the to accompany everything. It's not just background music, because my main complaint in a lot of films nowadays is that score is just used as background music. It's not used as a way to either enhance the experience or to tell you something in relation to the story. And it's like, no, I always bring up Old Boy, for example. The music complements the script, and the music also complements what you see on screen. Right. But if you watch a modern movie, most of the time it's just so that it doesn't sound empty in the background. Well, you know, just add something.
Right. If you've seen the Marvel movies, for instance, they play a lot of old music. They don't even have very few scores for the movies anymore.
Oh yeah, for sure. Like that's one of my main complaints of scores. Even the last movie I reviewed was The Marvels, and in The Marvels, I really pay attention to score when I'm reviewing a movie, and I realized that the main theme for The Marvels was exactly just a slowed down version of the Spider-Man theme, the Marvel Spider-Man theme, the MCU Spider-Man theme. Yeah. I was like, that's just how lazy they are at this point, wow. Just recycling it.
Well, in the first Marvel, Captain Marvel, they just, you know, do stuff like play I'm Just a Girl during the fight scene.
Yeah.
Like, just get super heavy-handed. But then there's also movies like Guardians of the Galaxy that do a very similar thing, but it's successful.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So I suppose it's just how it's implemented, you know.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I love how he says, what are you carrying, soldier? He's like, an M60? Well, thank you very much. I'll take it.
He's like, thanks, John A. or whatever, right? Get out of the car.
Yeah.
Let's get. Go on, go home and live, right?
Yeah, it's like, I'm giving you a chance. Mm-hmm. Go.
Chance I never. And he's running the wrong way.
Yeah, in my mind, the first time I saw this, I was like, he can probably get hit by a truck and die instantly at this point. Because right. You're going up the street. The trucks are coming down pretty quickly, too.
Right.
So they wouldn't have time to brake or anything. You'd just be hit.
Right. Can you imagine how quiet it is that day in the police department? Nobody making eye contact with anybody else, right?
Yeah, that's true.
Nobody. They bring this guy in, the reserve officer, just to cover, and he's like sleeping in the job because
right. The guy who was off last night.
Mm. Yeah.
This is where he tells he tells the chief, he's like, yeah, John Rambo is he's still here.
Right? You can like see the exclamation point appear above his head.
Right.
It's like the enemy is back.
Right.
Yeah, everything moves into motion. I guess this would be the beginning of the third act.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's coming to town now.
Yeah, the inciting incident, right? Or rising? Rising incident. Or he jumps on the back, steals a truck, and he's escalating everything upwards.
Exactly.
It's all coming to a head.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's taking the fight right to
them. I don't know what this guy in the police car was trying to do, trying to stop that big truck.
Pretty sure a pit maneuver is not going to work on that vehicle, but you know.
Yeah, I guess that's all they're taught, man.
Hey, you got to give them credit for trying.
You could hit something with that truck. You could hit a car with that truck and be like, "What was that?"
right. It reminds me of the old Looney Tunes where the big dog is being attacked by the little dog and just kind of standing there.
Like, yeah, right.
Yes. It's really what's it called? It's very, very interesting. At least you know they take out their guns and really try and shoot him in the truck.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure that he ends these people here though. This is one of the first times in the movie where he just like fully ends people.
Yeah, they hit that car pretty hard. And
yeah, that was pretty.
I don't think they're wearing seatbelts, or those were not the best vehicles to be in back in the day for crashes.
Unless this is an episode of G.I. Joe, all of a sudden those people didn't make it.
Yeah, right.
Boom. I think there's some serious damage.
Yeah, that's a big explosion, dude.
Yeah, that's going to hurt.
Yeah. No seatbelts.
What a cool effect, though. What a cool stunt, man. Whoever did that, bravo.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Seriously.
Yeah, definitely.
Cope is right. They used a bazooka on him. Now it's someone's got to pay for that.
Yeah. True. Yeah. True. He told him to let it go. They should have just let it go.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But nope, they didn't.
Yeah, he's leaving examples all over town about how they should just let it go. He just wanted some food. He probably would have just left if he had gotten some food.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking, Shield right. Wall.
Was that a pinto he hit?
Yeah, he probably went back just to get just to get food. That's the reason why he was walking back. And then, nope. Done. Yeah, sure, this button like a pancake or something. That was it.
I love the bumper here. Warring.
Yeah.
Cool.
That's what he's doing. That,
I had to save on the budget there. Knock out a couple letters, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I suppose if you're that close, you know that thing's dangerous.
Yeah, cars in the 80s just did that. Well, yeah, wasn't there a car that they had to recall? I forget which
one. The Pinto. The Pinto.
Was it the Pinto?
Yeah. If you hit it in the rear, it'd blow the tank.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
What was that movie with Val Kilmer? It's like it's a comedy. It was like one of his first movies.
Real Genius?
Yeah, Real Genius.
The Genius.
Yeah.
No, yeah, we had the one where he's in Germany.
Oh, Top Secret.
Were they in
Germany? Oh, yeah.
Top Secret. Yeah.
They have
the Germans chasing the Pinto and they just stop and just barely tap the back of the Pinto and it explodes.
Oh, yeah.
Boom.
Small. Man, Top Secret is a great movie.
Yeah.
I
forgot about that one.
Yeah.
One of them old ones that kind of gloss over. Yeah.
One of the old spoof movies.
Like Get Smart.
This is a good stunt too.
Yeah.
Yeah. Agreed.
Yeah. Adding some intensity to the Evil Dead bridge.
Yeah. I don't think I don't think that vehicle kept going after that point. I think that's why they cut it there.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
I'm pretty sure it went on to the side there.
Yeah. Probably crashed 100%.
It's the way you can see it. Like it's that. Yeah.
That's done.
That's got momentum.
Yeah,
got a little wobbly there.
You can kind of see it right there.
Well, look, the front wheels, it's already splayed out.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Right here until it starts leaning. It probably flipped right there.
Yep.
Right there. That,
man.
Dude.
Yeah.
Man, they were lucky.
And it's freaking stunts, dude.
Yeah, you don't see any of this now.
Yep.
No.
Some real pros working on this, man. You guys had some chops.
Mm-hmm. I love how he just takes out the gas tanks.
So right.
He's getting that fuel going everywhere.
Yeah, this was probably a pretty expensive shot, too.
Shell.
Yeah, because you can see the what's it called? Like, you can clearly see the fire really being, like, pushed out by proper fuel. So I really wonder how they did this one. Really, really do wonder.
And I think, you notice they keep the same directions that they keep showing in those shots too, where the stuff is spraying up in those directions, and later you can see the jets are to the same way.
Exactly. So, yeah. So I think they're just like pumping pure fuel and just setting it on fire, which is crazy.
Right. Good thing that M60 was right there on the end with all the ammo, right?
Yep.
Yoink. See it.
At this point, this is just exactly this. Look at the way it's spraying out. It's just a way to sell, not sell how real it is, because I mean, I guess everyone at this point knows that for gas stations, all this stuff is underground. I'm assuming people know this, but it's like in movies nowadays, you just see, oh, he would have probably just crashed into it, jumped out, and then it would have exploded. That would be it.
Or he would have jumped out like 20 feet before it gets to the thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so exactly. You can see the vehicle pull off and blow up in the distance.
Yep.
Get up and stand and look at the camera as he's walking.
All while he has the M60 and the rounds around him doing a tactical roll, you know, out of the
Yeah, that would have probably just been it. And then boom.
Right.
Beautiful explosion.
Yeah. Yeah. Agreed. Everybody in the town
sets
like,
the gas station on fire.
Yeah.
Sets the gas station on fire, pulls out all of the police to the gas station.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And then goes around and starts systematically getting rid of everything.
Yep.
So done. So well done. So well written. He actually used his brain to get these guys.
Oh, yeah. It's like, it's going to blow. They're all going to blow. It's like, yep. I mean, you're still in your car. Just, you know, drive around and leave in the car. Why are you getting out and running?
It's much quicker than you are.
Yeah. Because they see it blowing up. They're still in the car. I just reverse, chuck it in reverse and go. Done. Yeah, at this point, he's just telling the townsfolk, like, stay indoors, get inside. Yeah. I do like the fact that they actually show people out in the town. Because a lot of times when you have something that's going on like this, even in old movies that are like really well written, the towns just seem empty, really, really empty, except for the main characters, and that's pretty much it.
Yeah, it also plays up the part of human existence where in a small town where things are boring, if there was an explosion, the locals would be like, "What was that? I'm going to go check it out."
Exactly. Yeah. Shieldwall, I know the name Dairy Queen. I know it's a brand. I think they make ice cream or something like that. But like,
and terrible other stuff.
I think it's only in North America
that we still eat.
Yeah. So I've never had Dairy Queen over here. Like, I don't even think Dairy Queen is here. I even just found out that I have a Subway in my town, and didn't even know at all. So yeah, I think they're only in America.
It's like soft serve ice cream.
Right. Oh, yeah. If you want to know what Dairy Queen tastes like, take ice cream and add a bunch of sugar to it.
Right.
And then like break up candy bars and mix it in there.
Jesus.
Because they do that.
Blizzards. Yeah.
Yeah. This guy.
I like,
you're going to need
like
a bigger gun cabinet, buddy.
It's like, I have a better chance at surviving than you do. At least I know.
Right. You trust me. Right, might give me the edge I need, and he's right. That's the only thing that they have. That's it.
Yep.
Without him showing up, everybody in this town dies.
For sure. Yeah. They probably would have killed the entire police station and then just left.
Right.
And at that point, would you even be able to find him? No, he would have probably disappeared. I don't even think he would have been picked up. He would have probably just gone to live in the middle of the forest somewhere, build his own cabin. No one would have found him. You know.
Certainly. Yeah, the only reason anybody knows he's here is because he let them know where he was.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. I'll try Dairy Queen when if I ever go to the States, or I guess in Canada, they probably have some too.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll let you know, Shieldwall. If I try some, I'll let you know. I am a fan of ice cream, so.
Dairy Queen doesn't make the one I used to like. My favorite one used to have nerds in it.
Mm.
And for some reason, they don't make that anymore. I don't know. Huh.
Yeah, so probably there's a lot of
frozen nerd or something.
There's a lot of annoying discontinued good food products, like from chains. You know, it's really, really, really annoying that they don't make them anymore.
Agreed. I'm with you.
Yeah, Shieldwall. Back in the '80s, you could disappear. Just ask Ted Kaczynski, man. Dude just randomly left. That's it.
Right. Right, especially a wilderness survivalist expert, right? Like he could just be gone.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Just things happened. This thing here probably would not have even made national news, because back then, things happened that people had no idea happened. Now would be like all over the news, you know?
Right. Yeah, now you'd have like local news, social media, all of that stuff. It would be everywhere. I think that's the... I guess that's the burden of internet, is the fact that, like, I was thinking about this the other day, where has crime really gone up, or has it just the fact that it's everywhere now on the news once you turn it on?
Right.
You know? Yeah,
exactly. Agreed. Yeah, you have more access to the information now. It seems more because you're noticing it more, not because it's happening more.
Exactly. Yeah.
Right. Agreed.
This is a great shot as well, just showing the entire town.
Yeah. Yeah, he can see the whole place from up here. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He knows it's coming for him.
Yep. And he's using good tactics, too. It's not like he's being dumb and walking out and be like, here I am. I got a big, you know, flag showing where I'm at or something. He's hiding. He's using his own military training. It just, he's not special forces.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's crazy because nowadays... Yeah, he'd 100% just walk up to him and say, "Look, I'm here. I'm alive." It's like,
yeah.
He's like, yeah. It's not the same.
Right.
Like
he alarm. Shoots up the bank. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that bank.
He does that to bring people there.
Get the alarms right? going and.
Right, like to alert the stateies.
Yeah.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
That's what I always thought. Like he did that for a reason because they show him shooting at the bank and then taking out the power.
Yep.
You can hear the alarm go off.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, he's running the police all over the place, keeping them off guard.
But what I was thinking at that point was like it's cool because you'd probably be like of course you're distracting them, but at the same time, wouldn't where you're firing from make more noise than where the bullets are hitting? You get what I mean?
Maybe that was the point.
Yeah. He just has to run. Yeah. You gotta relocate all the time.
Right. Mm. Well, M60s are known for being super quiet.
Oh. Yeah.
Especially when you fire them automatic fire, you know.
Just full blown, yeah.
Now the alarms would still probably go off because the alarms would still go off because they ran off the telephone power.
Yep.
Right.
Not power.
Right.
So yeah, he could be running around shooting and the alarms would help cover some of his noise.
Mm. Yep.
Then he just gets prepped, you know.
Yeah, this is great.
Who did this better, Stallone here or Schwarzenegger in Commando?
Oh, this is, I think, not quite the same because Schwarzenegger was keeping a whole bunch of stuff and he used a saw blade in that dude's face, which was really cool. But this one, he's just getting rid of their ability to have these things, I think.
Mm. Right. He's gotten rid of their fuel.
Right.
He's gotten rid of the fuel, the power, and now they're ammo.
Right. And all their guns and everything are in there, except for the guns that are in the police station and the guns people have in their homes.
Yeah.
But you're not going to the gun store to stock up and come at this dude.
Yep. And also, like, we also see they also did, you know, the setup and the payoff is you've seen the amount of guns that they have locked in the police station. It's not that much. Right. That's it.
Right.
It's about what, 5, 6? I'd give or take 10, really, really pushing that to the max, and that's pretty much it in terms of assault rifles. After that, it's just, you know, normal service pistol. That'd be
it. Like, why shotgun police station with M16s? Like, they had a lot of them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I mean, I don't know, it's not like an AR-15 or something. M16, that should be rare. Be, I mean, unless they're the SWAT team, too, right.
They probably were. They're small. They went. Yeah,
they're everything, man.
Right.
We got to SWAT
my town.
We got to SWAT the drugstore again.
They didn't put out fresh donuts this morning. Bust out the M16s.
Mm-hmm. Jeez.
He's regretting his decisions at this point.
Oh yeah, it really is.
Maybe I shouldn't have got on the roof.
Yeah, and then he just lays into the police station.
Mm-hmm.
Which he knew there wasn't anybody in there.
I hope.
I'm not really sure why he was doing that. But
well, maybe it's just as like a fear tactic.
Right.
It's like I'm coming to get you.
And he did shoot
just throw off that guy to he also let him shut know he didn't have been made yet.
Mm.
He also shut all the lights out.
Yeah.
Yeah, by shooting the That's true.
The Transformer.
Yeah, yeah. Jay. Yeah,
but the M16, police station. I think it probably would have been on a police station. Probably would have been on a backup power.
Probably, actually. That's a, yeah.
That's why it was the only thing lit. That's why, because.
Mm. Yeah. I mean, Jay. I know that I guess for the amount of ammo and the amount of like firepower that cops had, I think that was by law. I think they made it to have more firepower on you after the Los Angeles. I forget the bank robbery, the LA bank robbery. Yeah, where they literally had to raid a gun store because their pistols weren't even piercing the robber's armor. And
Yep.
So they changed it by law after that. So cops were allowed to carry, I think, shotguns and way higher caliber stuff.
AR,
Oh, yeah.
To the Dirty Harry happened.
Yeah.
44 Magnum.
Very impractical, actually, as a gun.
Yeah, no doubt. Wow! Like, oh, what is that?
Done.
Hurt your shoulder firing that gun if you're not proper.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that would suck.
Yep.
Having the floor shot out from underneath that, you like that.
Especially glass.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ouchie.
You really have to pray that you'd like glass doesn't just land upside straight into you as you're falling.
Uh-huh. Right. Pale yourself. Yeah. Ooh,
yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well, he knew he was made, too. Mm-hmm. Knew it was over. He's just do it. Just do it.
Done.
I've been had. Like, you blew up the whole town, dude.
Mm-hmm. I just really, really love this like the composition of this entire scene. It's very, very good, especially considering that this is after he when he's about to do his speech and stuff, the way that it's lit, just the headlights from outside, all the floodlights that they've added, everyone is surrounding him, and it's just a lot of shadows being used, just really, really, really there to just reel you into the moment. I mean, just look at this shot there.
Yeah.
Really, really good.
Yeah, and the half and half composition here. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
The military one side, the police and civilian life on the other.
Yeah, with a straight line basically split in the middle.
Right. So good. So
really, really good.
And the acting in this part.
Mm-hmm.
Way better than should have been in a movie like this. This is like way above where they should have been.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I really think acting here is great.
Yes. It's the sequels that really gave the first Blood a bad name, like a bad rep, because the sequels are really just gung ho, full blown action. Even the video games, you know, video games as well. It's just boom, boom, boom. You know, they have that. I don't know if you guys. Yeah, I think it was the one that you mentioned earlier. Mm. It was the tactical shooter, the one where you had to just move your cursor around and then like shoot, and then roll around as well. Right. Yeah, I used to play that as well. I even have it on my computer. I have it like on an emulator.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, I love emulation. I use that all the time.
Same, dude.
Oh, man, look at that.
Look at really that. Good.
It just collapsed over in the corner.
Like the one scene anymore. He talks about how over there I was I could fly a gunship, I could drive a tank, I was in charge of multi-million-dollar equipment.
Right.
Here I can't even hold a job parking cars.
Right.
Yeah. Here I'm nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing at all. And I think like his speech in general, like to me personally, I think the speech that he has, anyone could have said it, you know, any veteran that was in the movie, you know, could have said anything like that. But the fact that it's Rambo who's saying it after seeing what we see that he's capable of, it just adds a lot more weight to the words that he's saying, because it makes the horrors of war more palpable, especially how he goes in detail of like, oh, yeah. He died right in my arms. He died here. I saw this dude. I saw this happening. Like, he blew up in front of me. I was trying to pick up my friend's pieces. And it's like, you see this dude who's been an absolute monster the entire movie, a tank, you know? And to see him broken down and crying like this, it's like, oh, my God. Yeah.
Right.
Really, 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 really sells the performance.
But yeah, certainly. Wrong. Yeah, and he starts the speech out with talking about how his buddy was going to take him in this car and they were going to go drive it until the wheels fall off. Mm-hmm. And then by the end of the story, the guy's like, I just want to go home. And he goes, why, man? I can't find your legs. Mm. Like, how you going to drive a car, man? I can't find your legs. And like, I had to scrape my friend off of me. Like, what's high-end graphic, traumatic craziness, the aftermath of war that people don't normally think about, the part that people put out of their minds, you know, the invisible scars that you can't see. I actually wrote down what he said, if you don't mind me saying it real fast.
Yeah.
He wrote down.
Yeah.
Sometimes I wake up and I don't know where I am. I don't talk to anybody. Sometimes a day, sometimes a week. I can't put it out of my mind. And that's it.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. It's over.
Yeah.
And unlike most movies, there's usually like a falling action section. Like, this was the climax, and it just kind of, and it was
done.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the falling action is happening during the beginning part of the credits where he's being walked out. So crazy powerful. And that, like, the last dialogue in the movie, and they just keep looking at everybody.
Yeah. In World War II, you had to get on a boat to get home. So they had time to, you know,
process,
get their mind right.
Right.
Yeah.
And Vietnam, you would be in combat one day, and the next day you're walking the streets of San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the culture shock of that.
Right. And I mean, even, you know, back in the 80s when this came out, First Blood is still one of the, like, first movies to really directly address this and use it as a plot point to show people what it was really like. Because, I mean, Vietnam War was just a few years back at this point, you know, 1982, still fresh in everyone's mind, you know, all the controversies, everything. And it's like, yeah, have to have this and to show, like, all the, I guess, you know, all the hippies that were protesting that, yo, these people actually really suffered, you know?
Right.
Cut them some slack. They're not the people to protest against. They're not the people to blame. They're just like regular people like you that went to war, because that's it.
Right. Yeah, and that's actually a good part right there, probably why he doesn't trust the civilians.
Uh-huh.
You know, but we don't find that out until the end of the movie. You know, there's a reason why he's skeptical of people. It's not just what happened in this town, but his past experience, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Wow, so well written. Just get out of here. So well written.
Man,
yeah. Really dude, well, I couldn't imagine that. By the way, all the service members, thank you. I can't imagine the sacrifices y'all had to make for us, man. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. It's really, 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 really graphic. It's like, that's enough, you know? I think that today they would have probably just showed it to you, showed the graphic aspect for shock value. But the thing that people don't understand today, especially filmmakers of today, is like, you don't need that shock value, because the inherent shock, people today, they've seen worse on TV, you know, like a kid today that's, let's say, 15 years old, not even 10 years old, has probably seen the goriest stuff known to man on his computer screen or in his phone screen, to the point just where if you show him, so if you see him, like, if you show him something like this, he'll be like, oh, it's just a movie, this is cool, this is gnarly, man. It's like, dude, just let the person imagine what's going on, just detail it. And let them imagine, and they'll just see the horrors through the other, through you know, Rambo's reaction of it.
That's exactly enough. Yes, it's not about traumatizing the audience, it's about the trauma's effect on the character. So you show his eyes, you show his facial expressions, you have him centered in the frame. Like, they're doing all these things, even with the lighting is shadowed in the background and lit up front, and it's coming naturally from the window, which was a narrative part of this whole scene. Like, it all just comes together. And there's no sound, right? It's just him being an awesome actor and saying well-written lines in a very convincing way.
Like, yeah.
I fully believe this dude would be crying right here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. Sorry, but very passionate about this movie. This is one of the great ones for me.
No, that's
and he almost cries here, too. Stuff, man. You can see his chin quivering a little bit, seeing what has happened here.
Cool. Well, he knew all these guys too. I mean, he may not have been on every op they went out on, but he knew them.
Right.
Exactly. And then, this beautiful scene just ruined in the sequels, where John Rambo just kills people. Like, what's the point, you know?
Well, you know, and it's been parodied all to hell and back.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, the fact that it went into that mindless shooter stuff, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know how the books did, but the movies certainly did, right? Like, UHF nailed it.
Yes, yes. Yeah. He literally took bullets and threw them at him, and he's like fell over because that was, you know.
Right. you know, what an iconic character though, man. Like growing up when I did, like I was born 3 years before this movie was made. So this guy was basically a thing my whole life.
Yeah.
Like, what an icon. And it all started right here. Nothing's wow.
Fantastic, man. Fantastic work all around. And the fact that they don't really linger on what happens to him after, because they'd probably like did even in the like well in the book Rambo dies. All right. Thank you, Jay. Yeah, but I mean, I feel like what they would do now is they'd probably go through all the proceedings after, probably interview him and stuff like that. It's like, no, you have to end here. That's it.
Right.
This is the chapter is done. You know, just close the book. Done for this. You don't need to know what happens later. Even if Rambo was a standalone thing, it would have been a great story. That's it.
Yeah.
I honestly think it should have been.
100%.
This should be a thing by itself.
Yeah, because I don't even understand why they had Rambo, because Stallone could have made Rambo, you know, 2, 3, 4, and 5, but they couldn't have named it Rambo. It could have been the start of a new franchise. That was it. And I guess people could say, oh, it's a Rambo ripoff, but at that point, who cares? Because like, yeah, at least the standalone movie was good. We're not gonna turn this PTSD stricken dude into a cold blooded killer once again just because. Right. Yeah, action.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And I don't know. This dude, I don't care how good he is. This guy's never getting out of prison. Ever.
Mm-hmm. No, right?
No.
Like, even if he gets the absolute minimum sentence for every single thing that he did, that's highly documented and evident all around them. Like, just beating up the cops, he would probably never get out of prison.
Oh, yeah.
Not to mention stabbing all those cops, and then not to mention killing those people, those two cops on the side of the road, and then blowing up half the town, maybe more.
Yeah. He's done.
And the craziest part too about the sequel is that like they actually send him to Vietnam. You know, it's like, I don't know. I would have expected him to have an absolute meltdown already just on the plane there.
Right.
Yeah, right.
I don't know.
I mean,
so couldn't weird.
Even make it.
Yeah, it's so weird what they did to this franchise. Really, really weird.
Yeah,
I suppose him going back to the trustingness of being out in the field with a squad kind of makes sense. Maybe.
Yeah. But still, you know, it's the aspect of look at what we've seen in like look at the way we've seen him react to just a dude approaching him with like something to shave his beard. Done.
Right.
That was it. Done.
Right.
So imagine being back in Vietnam, just on that soil, and having a dude like, I mean, you know, he probably, John Rambo probably sees an Asian in the street and has like a PTSD attack, to be fair.
Right.
At this point.
True. Yeah.
So to have him there on the soil is just, I don't know, it just really ruins the experience if you actually watch all of them as a whole and consider it to be the same John Rambo in each movie. But if you just watch part 2 and till 5 and then keep that as like, oh yeah, this is just like alternate universe John Rambo. Right. I think it could work, you know?
Right.
The multiverse of badassness.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, like it or not, this movie started off the 80s action movies.
Yep.
Yes, it did.
So without this movie, we wouldn't have Rambo, or we wouldn't have Commando,
Predator.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Schwarzenegger movies.
Yeah.
All of that.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. For sure.
Yeah. There's a ton of really great ones that came in this one's wake. And I mean, a lot of good ones are worked on by the people who worked in this movie.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, especially if you bring in, you know, the musicians, you know, the musicians, freaking not even fair how stacked these guys' resumes are.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, he worked on The Omen, Twilight Zone. Come on, man. Come on. Secret of Nim.
Yeah. Was that the Twilight Zone movie?
No, the series. 55 episodes. Yeah,
Jerry Goldsmith did the music for
59 to 64. Oh, okay.
Yeah, the original.
Okay, the original.
Cool. Yep, yeah.
I don't know.
Also worked on Total Recall.
Wasn't Stallone in a bit of a slump in his career?
Yeah.
I know Nighthawks didn't really do that well. They came out a year or two before this. He was in like Rhinestone with Dolly Parton around this time.
Right. Rocky yeah. 3 came out this same year.
Oh.
Okay.
All right. Yeah.
A lot of people like Rocky 3.
That's true.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, it was kind of just a weird, in a weird spot at this point. Yeah. But I mean, the good thing about the 80s is that it didn't take them long to make a movie. Well, it didn't take them as long as it does today. Back right. then, it was like every year you'd probably see Stallone in a different movie, basically. Right. 100%. Yeah.
And now they're taking two to three years now, something like that.
Yeah. On the minimum, yeah, depending on what type of movie. And even then, a lot of times you think the low budget movies would take like not that much time. But the issue about the low budget movies is that they can be wrapped up and done in about 7 months, but it will take them a year and a half to find a distributor, which is also a huge problem.
Yeah. And the editing and
CGI as well. Yeah, CGI.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. When you have to draw three quarters of your movie, it's going to take some time.
Yeah, right.
You have to wait for it to be rendered.
That's right. Like the prequel Star Wars movies. Maybe I was too harsh on them.
Green screen everywhere, man.
Yeah. Well, I'll say I'm really glad the amount of practical effects in this movie. The quality practical effects in this movie make me really happy.
Yes.
Just the orange explosions and the over the top gun ricochet noises and the inept National Guard guys come in there for some levity. And yeah, it's just, I don't know. I really like the way it all comes together, all with that scene at the end. Just,
I have to give props to the cinematographer, man. I think that the film looks incredible. And, you know, again, to the location scouts as well. Like, the location people, you did a great job. Cinematographer as well. Yes. Fantastic job. Because it looks like a modern film that you would see, like, made today, you know? You very rarely have these type of films that look like that from the 80s. One of them is... I always point to Ferris Bueller's Day Off. Ferris Bueller's Day Off looks like a modern movie that they were trying to emulate the 80s in, because it's just filmed so well. And man, it's really fantastic.
Yeah, Ferris Bueller, that's another great one. That's a really good example of did something so well it's been parodied into oblivion.
Yeah.
How many end credit scenes were there before that movie?
That's true.
Three or four.
I don't think it was the first, but man, come on, that's pretty popular. And even really Deadpool parried that at the end of his movie.
Yeah, exact same robe, place, everything. Just like, go away now. The movie's over. What are you doing?
Still here?
Ahead of his time, man. Tell me, John Hughes, that dude was a monster. Really was a monster. Dude could write a script in a week, and it would be a great movie. Absolutely insane.
Man, well, cocaine's a hell of a drug.
Yeah. Yep.
The 80s were riddled with it. And, you know, I hate to bring it up that way, but, I mean, it's hard to not acknowledge the different atmosphere that Hollywood was in the 80s. There's a lot of really terrible stuff happening, terrible people pulling terrible things, but they made some good movies.
Yep.
We just got done watching an example of one, or breaking down an example of one. And I don't know, man. Do you think it was worth it?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I think that, like, these people, they just had an idea, and then they were like, yeah, let's do it. And also the fact is that you also had all the... like, for example, all the stunt regulations and all of that, it's completely different today. It's just because it's become more bureaucratic instead of creative. And so you have a lot of suits in charge instead of creatives, which is the big issue. And back then, even the suits were sometimes creatives, which was good, you know? They were like, oh, yeah, let's do this. All right, sure, let's do it. Let's try it out.
Right.
Then
Friday the 13th, I think, is a good example of that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The Russo brothers.
So these are the movies that came out at the same time.
Season of the Witch
was number one.
Oh, wow. E.T. number one.
Hey,
I like E.T., but yeah.
Yeah.
That's a great movie, man. Iconic. I mean, I don't know about spectacular. I wouldn't put Rocky it in the top 3 came out
at the same time. Literally.
Yeah.
E.T., First Blood, Halloween 3.
Pink Floyd the Wall.
Interesting. Oh, wow. Yeah. I like Pink Floyd the Wall. It's a great, weird movie.
Yeah, right?
I guess it's just like a long music video, basically.
Right? Yeah, the Friday the 13th Part 3, that was 3D.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Back before anybody had really done a whole bunch of 3D stuff.
Yeah, it was back when it was just blue and red glasses.
Yeah, yep. Yeah, they had the two camera next to each other.
Mm-hmm.
They did a lot of really gimmicky at the camera stuff, too.
Early 80s had a little spate of 3D that came back. Space Hunter was one, and a couple others were schlocky. It didn't last long.
Yeah, it's weird because it's always the weird. It's crazy to think that it's always the weird schlocky horror movies that innovate in a weird way. It's right. Crazy to think of that. It's not the big budget stuff. It's just the low budget filmmakers doing what they do best. That's how they innovated. You know, look at Evil Dead, for example. How many horror movies or how many movies in general just try to emulate Evil Dead style for some scenes?
Agreed.
It's like, it's a lot of low budget creativity. And today, which we do not have. Well, we have low budget creativity. We just don't have big budget creativity, which is the main problem.
True.
Yeah,
because they were willing to take risk back then. That's how we got all these firsts. Your Nightmare on Elm Streets, your Texas Chainsaws, your Halloweens, you know, things like that. On that list as well was Fast Times at Ridgemont High.
Yeah.
A great example of you don't need a lot of money to make an iconic scene. You just have a hot chick being wet and get out of the pool.
Get out of the pool. That's it.
Like, it doesn't take a lot. You know?
Yeah. And like, people really, really took risks, and sometimes it paid off. You know, as you said, Nightmare on Elm Street, Freddy Krueger, like New Line Cinema is the house that Freddy built. That's literally like New Line Cinema.
1984.
Exactly. Nightmare on Elm Street is what basically like revived New Line Cinema. And it's crazy to think that, you know? And
they're on their way out.
Taking the risks. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
It's crazy. The house that Freddy built. It's insane. Yeah. It's like,
And a good example of creative versus suit in that one too with the ending.
Mm-hmm. Yep. That's true. It's very, very very interesting to see the current landscape of Hollywood, because it's mostly just marketing teams now and safety. Yeah. So safety would be, all right, we have to inject this much money. What do we inject it in? Should we make a ton of smaller movies, or should we just make one big movie, which is a remake or a sequel to a big IP, which we know is going to be just a cash grab?
Right.
That's it. Yeah. Right. What's the safest bet? The cash grab.
Yeah. Spaceballs 2, The Search for More Money.
Right.
Basically.
Merchandising.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it's so obvious. And then when people call them out for it, people get upset with you. It's like, man, is pattern recognition really considered to be hatred in this day and age? Come on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But none of that was around when this came out. What a great time to be watching movies in 82. So many great ones there. That's the big argument between 82 and 84, which was the best movie or the best year for culture.
Man, 84.
84 had some great stuff because it also had 82 around when 84 happened.
Mm-hmm.
But not the other way around.
It's crazy because movies back then used to stay for, 12, 13 months at the cinema?
Yeah, right. Right.
That's
insane. Yeah. You could go watch Star Wars in January, come back in December and still watch Star Wars.
Right.
So, that was it. Now it's a month and a half and done.
Yeah. Literally, boom. That goes behind a paywall because it goes on Disney Plus or Paramount or whoever.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yep. Exactly. Yeah. They're trying to make their money through streaming. And I mean, sometimes it's so bad to the point where I would like to go watch a film at the cinema. I just don't have time. And then by the time I actually have time to go, I see that it's out on digital. I'm like, all right, well, what's the point of yeah? Fine. Why?
Why would I'll just wait a month and watch it on my TV.
Exactly. Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. Especially considering that you don't know the quality of movies nowadays. Hey, you know?
Right.
I have to say, Godzilla Minus One is still not out on video.
What? Yeah, it's coming out on May 1st. They announced for the Blu-ray, but in Japan. But they haven't announced for the American release yet. They announced it, I think it was 4 days ago, actually. They announced the Blu-ray. So normally it comes out Blu-ray May 1st in Japan, a box set with the black and white version as well. And then I don't know if they have a U.S. release. They don't even have a digital U.S. release.
Really?
I mean, that's on par with with Japanese releases, because Japanese releases, especially if you watch anime movies, always take about a year to reach the West, which is really annoying.
Yeah. But it,
I'll bet that black and white version is awesome.
Especially when you have a good movie and it's not in the theater very long.
Yes.
That's where you make your big bucks with a good movie. You keep it in the theater longer.
Mm-hmm.
It's really weird how they just ramrod it through and
Didn't
make any sense.
Yeah.
Why didn't we make any money? Yeah, I don't know. Maybe leave it in there longer.
Yeah.
We'll get more money.
Maybe you leave it longer for 2 weeks at the cinema and we'll make more money.
Right. Well, yeah. That's that person driving on the bike and they stick the bar in their own wheel and then blame somebody else.
Yeah.
Their marketing strategy apparently.
So guys, that was great. That was great discussion. Glad y'all could come on and talk about this. Is really good.
Great movie. Yes.
Just great.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks. I had a great time rewatching it again. Forgot how much I actually really, really liked this movie.
Same.
It's nice meeting you too. It's nice.
Yeah, nice meeting you too, man. Jacob. Finally, talking to you guys in the chat usually. So it's great to finally meet you and speak with you in live and just talk about First Blood as well, which is a really great movie. So it's cool.
Yeah, definitely.
Likewise, man. Agreed.
Yeah. And Jacob, thanks for having Blair on again.
Yeah, definitely. I enjoy having y'all.
Yeah.
Y'all on. Y'all always bring out good. Good content. Or no, not content. Just good discussion, good insights in these movies. It's really, really good. Does anybody have anything they want to plug?
Me and Jacob are going to be on Roman of the Empires show Thursday. Nice.
Yeah.
Really awesome. Nice. What are you guys discussing? Is that free range?
I think it's just a free range show.
Yeah, I think it's a free range.
Right?
Nice.
Yeah,
hurry. Yeah, those are cool. Are really cool those to watch, man. Fun. Yeah,
agreed.
Especially,
I've been doing a show on Sundays,
nice,
called Reality Based Music on Ryan Roger at the Ace Channel. And myself, my son, my friend Jim, and Ryan, we bring musicians on and just talk to them about how they got started, what their influences are, blah blah blah. It's a good time. Nice. It's a lot of fun. Yeah.
Nice. I'll have to check that one out, man.
Yeah. It's every Sunday at, I think it's 9 p.m. UK time.
Oh, okay. Cool. That's like, I guess, 10?
5 o'clock here.
Yeah, 10 p.m. my time. I'm 1 hour ahead of UK.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. Okay.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, on my end, I don't really have anything to plug right now except for... two hosts, which is the show that I co-host with Dark Hour, this Saturday at 1 p.m. Cool. EST on my channel. We're covering Kung Fu Hustle, which is one of my all-time favorite martial arts movies that I love. And that's how we're going to cap off two hosts, martial arts, because we only did martial arts movies for the month of March. So, yeah, it's going to be cool.
Nice. Cool. Well, I've next week, I've got the 39 Steps of Alfred Hitchcock movie.
Nice.
Good one. Good suspenseful. Oh, it's from, I think, 39, I think.
Yep. 39. Yep.
Yep. 35. Yeah, wow.
35.
So yeah, I've got that coming up. I think that's
so that's going to be going into public domain soon. That's huh? it.
Probably, yeah. Man, old Hitchcock was old Hitchcock was something else, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. He was.
Oh yeah.
Pioneer.
Yeah, I think I'll also be on Potato Raven's channel on Friday, and I'll be on Roman's show Thursday. So that's nice. All I got coming up.
Awesome.
So yeah. Guys, thanks again for coming on and hanging and talking about this great movie.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks to the chat.
Pleasure.
Yeah, thank you, chat.
Take care, everybody.
Bye.
Yep. Later, everybody.
Bye.
Have a good week.
Yeah, I wish you all luck and fortune.
Yep.